This is the Buzz Adams Morning Show podcast. Barstool Talk Daily. Except it's really early in the morning and no booze. For the most part.
Adams Morning Show, Monday through Friday, 5 to 10. KLEQ and KLEQ HD1, El Paso, a Town Square media station.
Good morning.
Oh, no, it isn't.
I'm tired!
Gonna be on.
Good morning.
Oh, no, it isn't.
I'm tired!
Gonna be honest, did a little too much, gave you a little too much. We're gonna bring it down. We're gonna bring it down.
It's today, Tuesday.
Actually, today is weekend Tuesday.
What does that mean?
What does that mean?
Yeah, it's like a casual Friday, but even more chill, and on a Tuesday.
So let's get this party started.
It's showtime!
From the KLAQ studios in beautiful, sunny El Paso, Texas.
Does anyone copy my transmission?
The Buzz Adams Morning Show is back.
Good morning, my neighbor!
Only on 95.5 KLAQ El Paso.
All right, thank you so much for the introduction. Good morning, everybody. And welcome to the morning show for this Tuesday morning. It is May 21st. Thanks for joining us. Very excited about today's show. We are going to have a couple of musicians that you may be familiar with from the band Shinedown. All right, let me just set the stage here with a little Shinedown. Drummer Barry Kirch from Shinedown is going to be joining us later on the show today, and he is going to be talking about the new Symptom hot sauce from Shinedown. You can now own, if Shinedown is your favorite band, you can own your favorite band's brand of hot sauce. And I'm very excited to talk to Barry Kirch, who's been the drummer for Shinedown since the beginning of the band. 20 some odd years ago. So we're going to have that coming up. And then later in the show,
I started singing bye bye Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry.
We're going to interview legendary singer-songwriter Don McLean, the American Pie guy.
The American Pie guy.
Yeah, and he's got new music out that he wants us to hear. This is a like a dream come true for me.
And you're so excited for it.
Well, I don't think you fully understand everything. Don McLean has been a kind of reclusive artist. You know, he doesn't... for most of his career, he did not do a lot of interviews, so... The fact that I'm getting to talk to Don McLean is sort of like if I got to interview Bob Dylan. Or Gordon Lightfoot, for that matter. Hey, don't you think that in 200 years, people will still be singing American Pie?
Oh, yeah.
I think
for
in 200 years, if you walk into a bar any place and say, a long, long time ago, everybody will start singing along. I can still remember.
I started singing bye bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my
they may not know what the words mean in 200 years, but I think people will still be singing American Pie.
Now, didn't you say that he also wouldn't perform that song for years live?
That, you know, interesting that you asked. That is what I had always heard. I had heard that Don McLean did not play his biggest hit of all time, American Pie, in concert. But in the course of preparing for the interview, I can tell you this from DonMcLean.com. You ready?
Yes.
DonMcLean.com says, Don McLean always sings American Pie in concert, despite press accounts to the contrary.
Ooh,
despite
scandalous.
What you may have heard.
And I heard it enough that I believed it. You know, it's like, oh, I guess he just doesn't play American Pie in concert.
I thought the most scandalous thing was that he was dating somebody 40 years younger than
48
him.
48 years age gap.
Really?
Yeah, because he got a Hollywood star on the Walk of Fame.
Showed up with his trophy girlfriend.
Right.
His sugar baby.
Yeah. I got no problem with it. Hope he's enjoying his life.
You're putting out applications.
Yeah. So Don McLean. Here's another interesting Don McLean factoid for you. Don McLean's original manuscript for American Pie
was American Cake.
So it was handwritten, sold for $1.2 million at auction in 2015, making it the third highest auction price ever for an American literary manuscript. I wonder if he got all that. I wonder if he was just like, thanks for the $1.2 million, guys. Hmm. So Don McLean coming up later. Barry Kirch from Shinedown is going to be on the show. Did you make anything with the hot sauce?
I did.
Did you take the hot sauce?
I did not have a chance to take it this weekend. So
where is the hot sauce?
It's right here.
All right, we're going to have to put it on crackers or something.
Well, Joanna and I already ate it.
Oh, yeah, we ate some already of it.
It's probably too hot for you.
Yeah, but I feel like it's part of my job is doing the interview that...
Okay.
That I need to eat a little bit, you know, on a cracker or something.
We're going to have to tell Barry, it's too hot for
Yeah,
Buzz.
Right. I'm really...
And he's a little sensitive.
Okay. Let me ask you a question. Yes. Well, before we do the interview about the hot sauce, okay?
Okay.
Does anybody ever feel like there's like one factory where they make hot sauce and they just slap different labels on it so people can call it their own and their fans can have their hot sauce?
No.
It's like with celebrity tequila. I think there's one big tequila factory and they just put different labels on the same thing.
If you reduce every hot sauce to being the same, is that what you're trying to say?
Every hot sauce comes in different flavors.
Sure textures.
Right.
Textures, yeah.
What do you mean, whatever?
Does it really?
You don't need hot sauce.
At some point,
you
Philistine. It's just hot.
You Philistine.
It's just hot.
So I was telling everybody that Nico missed yesterday's show because he needed a mental health day after DJ Cooch made fun of his hair so much on Friday.
Did you guys really say mental health today?
Yeah, that you needed a...
why would you do that?
Somebody in the chat said it and we thought it was funny.
Yeah.
So I wanted to say sorry. And also, DJ Cooch started it also.
It really was DJ Cooch.
No, it wasn't. It was you guys telling everybody yesterday that I wasn't here because of my hair.
Says, and then it had nothing to do. Shaved your head.
It had nothing to do. First of all,
I'm sorry.
I thought you were going to get a tambourine and start collecting money at the airport.
You guys are such jerks.
That Nico was so affected by DJ Cooch's comments about his hair.
That's what someone said. That he
went. He went out and he had his hair.
That's what Buzz said.
How do you know?
Because you just said it. You just said, I got everybody to believe this thing yesterday.
Oh, I'm not saying it's not true.
Yes, you are. You are saying it's not true. You basically just said it's a lie.
Can we see the dome? You got a cap on now. What kind of cap is that? Is that from the Mutz Cantina?
It is.
Is it?
Yeah.
They got a front page article about Mutz.
Yeah.
You were there on Saturday.
I was there on Saturday.
Let me see your cap so we can see your hair and you tell us all about Mutz.
No. We're going back to how you guys, first of all, inflicted serious emotional damage.
See, you did take an emotional health
on
day.
My mom. Okay, and no, I did not take an emotional health day. I can't just take a sick day without you guys, without the world knowing. You couldn't move on. My mom called me up crying.
Crying. Well, you know it is never my intention.
Because of your impression of her.
I told you that's not what she sounds like.
And she kept going, why are they saying these things?
I told him that's not what she sounds like.
And I was like, what do you mean? And she was like, they're saying things about you. And then...
Nico.
Oh, my God.
My beautiful boy, you've got to turn on the radio.
You're going to make her upset again.
You're going to make her sad.
That is never my intention to make Mrs.
You know
Ajimian
I'm
going to
get
sad.
Her on the phone, and you're going to have to talk to her in person.
I want to
only if it's on the air.
Okay. All right. And then I get a call from DJ Cooch the whole time. Like, two calls from Cooch yesterday, because I guess some listeners...
Heard that you didn't come into work.
Heard what you were saying to people.
That at his show, he mentioned, like, your hair.
Yeah, he did, apparently, several times.
On stage, you mean?
On stage. But that's not that bad, because that's a stage thing. And then he's like, yeah, people were calling me saying I ruined you and I made you go get your haircut. And I was like, no.
He did. He got it cut short.
Not at all because of DJ Cooch or any of that stuff. I had been needing a haircut, and, you know, or anyways. So.
Wow. Ooh. Your beautiful curls.
That is close enough that you better put sunscreen on top of your head.
Actually,
if you go out into the sun. Seriously.
You're like in that scene in Napoleon Dynamite where Pedro? Like, I shaved my head.
You know, somebody brought that up on Friday. It was like, why don't you just go Pedro?
It might be good. It's getting hot.
It might be good.
Sometimes I feel like pulling a Britney and just shaving it.
Yeah. Somebody last week said your hair looks like Bill from King of the Hill. But yeah. I think it looks, maybe now it looks more like Bobby from King of the
Hill.
It
is a Bobby, yeah.
Yeah, it is a Bobby. I can rock it. I can rock whatever.
It's not bad.
I'm a handsome man.
Yeah,
my mom looks, says so.
You look like when we take Junior to get shaved for the summer.
That is what I'm always telling him.
Stop
so
that.
Handsome.
I'm sorry. I just can't. I can't stop myself.
You're gonna have to talk to her. You're going to have to talk to my good friend Melinda.
Yeah.
And apologize.
All right. Well, Nico's here. He got over his mental health day and made it into work today.
Is that why you're
around? I'm sorry. I can't just have a normal sick day. I can't just have a normal sick day.
I thought you were sad.
I was not sad.
Let's get a look at El Paso weather and the golfer's forecast.
You guys suck.
Brought to you by Painted Dunes Desert Golf Course. Sunny today, 95. I wonder if we hit 100 yesterday. It did not quite feel...
It felt like it was 99.
It
felt like it might have been close. Right. I'm not sure we got to 100. I could really tell that 1 degree temperature difference.
But then it was windy, so I was confused.
That is true. It was very windy yesterday. And that kind of encapsulates the forecast through the week and the weekend, which is the Memorial Day weekend. Sunny. Highs are going to be mostly in the mid-90s. We don't see any rain in the forecast. Not through next Monday, anyway. And every day in the afternoon, the winds are going to be blowing to 1 degree or another, mostly 15 to 20 miles an hour. I'm seeing a couple of days here where the wind might even get up a little more than that on Saturday. Next Monday, though, winds will die down. They're actually going to give us a really nice Memorial Day on Monday. Sunny, 95, but winds between 5 and 10 miles an hour. Monday, if you want to know the truth, is your real target day for golf. This is the Golfer's Forecast, brought to you by Painted Dunes Desert Golf Course. You can set up all your tee times and reservations online at painteddunes.com. That's painteddunes.com. Or give them a call at the Pro Shop. Their number is 915-821-2122 for Painted Dunes Desert Golf Course. Joanna, why don't you give us a preview of the Hollywood Cheese May and what's coming up in your entertainment report today?
Okay. So Scarlett Johansson says that she was shocked and angered over OpenAI's use of a voice that was eerily similar to hers.
All right. I saw the initial story that said that there were people who were saying, hey, there's one voice setting that you can, it sounds like Scarlett Johansson. Specifically, they were saying Scarlett Johansson in the movie Her.
Her.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what is Scarlett Johansson's move now?
I'll let you know in entertainment news.
Oh, girl, you reeled me in.
See what I did?
Yeah, you put the bait out there and I took it. Nico Adjimian is going to have a look at news headlines coming up later. Nico, what's coming up in the news?
Courtney Cox says Matthew Perry still visits her 7 months after death.
That's a news story.
Disbelief.
Are you doing that story in entertainment? Because it sounds much more like an entertainment story to me.
Yeah, I just saw it, but I could. I mean, it's like this is news in a way.
Okay.
I say it unbelievingly. Like, really?
You did.
I started singing bye bye Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Them good old boys.
It looked like
our boss kept going, God, I hope Buzz doesn't bump Barry for this.
Why would you say that?
You have our boss worried.
There was a moment where I thought the Shinedown guy, Barry Kirch from Shinedown, was going to conflict with Don McLean.
And Kevin was like,
Kevin was like, well, you're going to have to drop Don McLean. Shinedown's one of our big artists. And I'm like, hold on a second. I don't cancel Don McLean for anybody. If it was Brent from Shinedown, I wouldn't cancel Don McLean.
What's wrong with Barry? Barry's been
nothing's
there the whole
wrong. Nothing is wrong. Barry's great. Barry's great.
I started singing bye bye, Miss American Pie.
Does he have other songs?
Yeah, I was going to say, at least Barry has other songs.
Were you going to ask him about like the American Pie movies? And the Don, and then be like, how do you feel that your song now
is in a movie about banging pie?
That's what I said.
Here you go. Here's another big hit song.
Starry, starry night.
Oh, my God.
You've heard this before,
no, haven't
you?
No, I haven't.
I swear to God, you've heard it.
Blue, okay, yes, gray. I've heard it, but...
No.
Look out on a summer's day.
But definitely not in my top hits.
Oh, okay. Well, then, have you heard of this one?
I started singing.
I mean, that's the only
every
one?
Every karaoke, yeah.
My Chevy to the levee, but the levee was...
I'm telling you.
Like, that's how he feels about Madonna's...
It's weird for you to get excited over a one-hit wonder.
You know what? You can take another mental health day if you're going to start talking that noise in here.
Today, May 21st.
Today may as well be sponsored by your mom. It's Eat More Fruits and Veggies Day. Or you get no dessert, mister. It's end of the world day, but relax. To remind us how fake apocalypse warnings stress all of us out, meditate on that. It's World Meditation Day. And it's Talk Like Yoda Day. Nerds. Happy birthday, Buffalo Bills quarterback Josh Allen, Notorious B.I.G., and Mr. T.
I pity the fool.
And that's your daily calendar.
95.5 KLAQ.
Momentum Premium. Visit the Find a Dealer tab to locate your nearest local champion dealer at WindSupplyElPaso.com.
El Paso's own live and local The Buzz Adams Morning Show. 95.5 KLAQ.
All right, we've got Today in Sound Clips on the way. Our first look at news headlines. It's going to be a little bit of everything, some world news, some national news, some entertainment news. Got it all coming up for you. But I do want to take a moment to remind you that this is the last week that we're going to be doing registration for our VIP Upheaval Festival experience. The winner of this is going to get airfare, accommodations for 3 nights, and tickets to both days of a 2-day massive lineup of rockers in Grand Rapids, Michigan. The VIP Upheaval Festival experience will have you checking out bands like Godsmack, Bad Omens, and Beartooth. As part of the prize package, we also throw in $500 spending cash. That'll be yours as well. And it is a code word contest. So this week through Friday, listen for code words to enter on the KLAQ mobile app. As soon as you hear those words, open the mobile app, enter the code words, and the more you get, the better your chance to win this great trip to go see the Upheaval Festival experience in Michigan. Here are the approximate times for the code words. Monday through Friday, approximately 10 a.m. is when you're going to hear the first code word, 2 p.m. for the second one. For the third one, that'll be around 5 p.m. and 8 p.m. during Loudwire Nights. Remember, these times are approximate. You can win the VIP Upheaval Festival experience courtesy of Me Entertainment.
And now, Today in Sound Clips.
All of the day's news with accompanying sound bites and actualities. The White House announced yesterday the chairman of the FDIC will be stepping down. That's the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. Martin Grunberg will be leaving the position once his successor is appointed. And Joe Biden said he will reportedly name a replacement soon. The FDIC chair was grilled for 2 days last week in congressional hearings that mostly focused on the workplace culture at the FDIC. Which Senator John Kennedy of Louisiana said came from as many as 500 of FDIC's 6,000 employees. A report released last week by the law firm of Cleary, Gottlieb, Stein, and Hamilton cited incidents of stalking, harassment, homophobia, and other violations of employment regulations by senior members of the FDIC. During a committee hearing yesterday, Senator Tim Scott told FDIC Chairman Martin Grunberg that he should quit
The level of intimidation that is embedded in the culture after a decade of your leadership, you can't just unravel it. You can't unscramble that egg. You've heard me say this to you directly. You should resign.
The complaints against senior members, senior staff at FDIC include a female field examiner who said she received a picture of an FDIC senior examiner's private parts. So it was an FDIC pick. It was an FDIC pick, a FDIC pick. And another woman,
are you looking at me?
Said that she was stalked by a coworker.
Get it?
Here is Senator John Kennedy of Louisiana, who said there's no place for creepy old men in places of power.
The Me Too movement reminded us all that America is no place for creepy old men who sexually harass and demean their employees.
Boy, there were probably a lot of senators or representatives in there sweating it while he was like, crap, is he going to start naming names of people in this room?
Yeah, him.
As far as I know, John Kennedy of Louisiana has never been, there's never been any suggestion of impropriety of that kind.
But he's a creepy old man in other ways.
Yeah, I don't know if he is. Here is Senator Kennedy again, who made it clear that there weren't supposed to be exceptions to what the Me Too movement brought about.
There's not supposed to be a carve out for bigots and perverts at the FDIC to harass their coworkers when they're supposed to be regulating America's banks.
Speaking of bigots and perverts, I guess the prosecution rested its case against Donald Trump yesterday in a Manhattan courtroom.
You were like, get it? FDIC pick?
An F dick pick.
There you go.
That's the way to deliver the punchline.
An F dick pick.
Enough with the word.
Let's
cool it there.
Yeah, sorry.
Senator John Kennedy revealed, not that John Kennedy. There's another John Kennedy. He's a senator from Louisiana. He revealed widespread harassment at the FDIC after reading senior officials' alleged texts.
There's 6,000 workers at the FDIC. In total, more than 500 reported misconduct by their bosses.
It's kind of interesting, though, that a lot of the senators from Senator Kennedy's own party were in New York just to show up and pose with Trump outside his courtroom. And then he's going on and on and on about liars and perverts. And what else did he describe? Have you seen how they've been showing up? Like different Republicans show up and they're all dressed the same as Trump. It looks like a groomsman's photo. Is what it looks like more than anything else.
Well, he's asked them to come, and he's specifically asked bomb throwers Vivek Ramaswamy and Matt Gaetz to go watch the trial and then come outside
and talk trash about
the judge and the daughter
or whatever, because he's not allowed to.
Right.
So he's recruiting these useful idiots to get around the gag order for him. And it seems like they're more than happy to do that. I mean, it's disgraceful.
Mike Johnson went. I mean, how many, in what other era would politicians kowtow? In American politics.
Oh, before America lost its mind, the Republicans long ago would have stood up and said, we just can't condone all this stuff anymore after January 6th for sure.
Right.
In America's past. And I realize we did go to civil war at one point, but during the Nixon administration, eventually it was a group of Republican lawmakers who went over to the White House and said, look, they got you, and the best thing you can do is step down now, but not this batch. All right. Republicans Ted Cruz and Katie Britt introduce a bill to protect IVF. That's in vitro fertilization. Earlier this year, a Democratic-led effort to introduce legislation to protest access to in vitro was on the floor, but the bill failed. The idea isn't dead. In fact, two senators introduced a new bill to protest IVF. And I think they mean protest. There's two different kinds of protest. I saw an interview with the Pope yesterday. I didn't know the official position of the Catholic Church is anti-in vitro fertilization. But he talked about it again. Like, he talks about in vitro fertilization in the same breath as abortion. Joanna, you're Catholic, right?
Yeah.
Did you know they were against in vitro fertilization?
I did not.
Oh, yeah. No. I listened. The Pope was on 60 Minutes on Sunday, and then they had an hour-long interview with him yesterday, and he made it very clear that it's a, it's a sin.
Whoa,
to have IVF. Senators Ted Cruz and Katie Britt introduced the IVF Protection Act, which would ban states from receiving Medicaid funding if they put an outright ban of in vitro into place.
Like Alabama.
There is no word on what chances the bill could have of passage in the Senate. But yesterday, Ted Cruz said the procedure should be legal, in his opinion, for one very simple reason.
As a matter of law, this should be a choice that is available for parents because it is profoundly pro-family.
And Katie,
yeah, why would the Catholic Church put it with abortion when you're making a baby?
They always bring up, well, the Pope, anyway. You
have to get rid of some embryos. Not all the embryos are used.
No, it doesn't seem to be. It's like couples who can't have a child on their own should adopt. Seem to be Pope Francis's position on it. Here's Katie Britt. You remember her from the rebuttal to Biden's State of the Union speech a couple months ago. Katie Britt says that IVF fits within Republican values.
They know that we are the party of families. Republicans are the party of moms, the party of children, the party of life. And we're going to keep marching that forward.
Would you ever have imagined, like even 5 years ago, that, oh, you know, the 2024 election, it's going to get into whether IVF is morally right anymore.
I don't think that there are many people in the United States, and I would say even among Catholics, who really have a problem with IVF.
We just had a whole problem with that in Alabama when they passed the law that said, we just had this issue. Alabama passed a law that was the most restrictive anti-abortion law in the country.
Oh, you can't destroy, because in an in vitro situation, you've got more than one. How does it work?
Right, they have more than one embryos, and not all of them are used. But anyways,
so that would have effectively banned IVF.
In vitro, right.
This reminds me of when I was a kid, because people would occasionally do this. And I'm talking about like doing a high wire tightrope between the World Trade Center buildings. That was something that some trapeze nut did back in the 70s.
And somebody did it again?
A daredevil named Reckless Ben. Reckless Ben, looking for fame on YouTube, is in trouble in Los Angeles after a stunt where he walked a tightrope between two buildings. They don't say what the buildings are, but I assume one of them is the the Nakatomi Plaza building. While police were still after him, Reckless Ben the Daredevil decided to give a short interview to an LA TV crew.
So the police are definitely after me, which is why it's very risky for me to be doing this interview. There's a police officer right there. If that police officer just turns his head and looks at me, I'm in jail. So it's like, I don't know. But with great risk comes great rewards. It was very scary. I was looking down. Because like when you get scared, you start to shake. And then when you shake, the line shakes, then you fall off. And then I didn't want to fall. So you just have to calm your mind.
All right. Do you want to see a little bit of the coverage just to see what this dude was doing?
But this YouTuber may have taken the top spot, although done illegally.
And dangerously.
Hi, Jory Michelle. Yeah, this guy is a daredevil. Take a look. As we pan up to these buildings, you can see just high up he was.
Look at this.
He used a line to walk a tightrope across the two towers here in downtown LA.
That's insane.
So I'm between the two abandoned graffiti towers in downtown LA.
If you know downtown LA, they got a couple of towers there that are called the graffiti towers. Look at this.
It's all on video, as you can see. He calls himself Reckless Ben. The 28-year-old posted this clip on his YouTube channel.
What would you say? That's probably in the background. Those are probably 20-story buildings. So he's got to be like 40 or 50 stories up. That's certain death, right?
Oh, yeah.
If you take that is absolute. You hit the concrete and you're just going to be a leaky bag of mush.
Pulling off this dangerous stunt. This happened earlier this month. These abandoned towers have become a popular spot for artists to create content and paint graffiti.
All right, so I guess that's why they're called the graffiti towers. Almost 30 people were arrested in Florida on Saturday night after a fight broke out at a skating rink. It did not happen on skates, though. The fight happened in the parking lot. Here is the manager of Astro Skate, Andrea Leary, talking about what led up to the massive fight and the 30 arrests.
Later found out that it was not a little party, it was a big event. They had posted social media. She went on their Instagram Live, Facebook. They went all over social media, pretty much bashing us and told the kids, come anyway. We encouraged all the kids to please call your parents. You need to get picked up. We had deputies on staff, on duty, off duty.
All right. Courtney Cox is talking about the late Matthew Perry during an interview on CBS Sunday morning. Courtney Cox says that she still gets visits from Matthew Perry's, I guess, ghost.
I talked to my mom, my dad, Matthew. I feel like there are a lot of people that are, I think, that guide us. I do sense, I sense Matthew's around for sure.
Courtney Cox also says she has nothing but good things to say about her late castmate, Matthew Perry.
I think he's probably one of the funniest human beings in the world. He's just so funny. He is genuinely a huge heart, obviously struggled. I'm so thankful I got to work so closely with him for so many years.
Joanna, before I'm just going to decide whether to do these sound clips or not.
Hey, I got one too, if you want.
Do you have any interest in what's going on in JoJo Siwa's world?
Ugh.
No.
Do you know who she is?
Yes.
Somebody came on Saturday Night Live and did an impression of her, and my daughter happened to be watching with me, and she said, oh, that's exactly what JoJo Siwa's like now. So
yeah, well, she just wears weird costumes.
Okay. Well, she went to Disney World for her 21st birthday and got very, very drunk. So that's what the story was.
That sounds fun.
You got a clip for us?
Yeah. Abby Phillip from CNN was doing an interview with rapper Cameron, and it probably wasn't a good choice to bring him on.
You sure we're okay to play this then?
Yeah. Yeah, it's CNN.
Let's have it.
Known as the rapper Cameron. He's also the co-host of the podcast It Is What It Is. Thanks for being here. First, when you saw that video.
So she immediately starts asking him about P. Diddy stuff. And he goes on to say, yeah, it was terrible.
But I want to say, first of all, when I seen the video, everything in the video was egregious. I'm against.
All right. So she keeps asking him about P. Diddy for some reason. Like, that's all the interview.
Was he under the impression the interview was going to be about some...
About his podcast, and he has this sexual stimulant drink called pink unicorn powder.
Uh-huh. And it's a what now?
It's a sexual stimulant drink that he sells.
Okay.
Oh, those are very popular.
Was P. Diddy on Unicorn P or whatever it's called?
No, but Cameron was in the middle of this interview.
Okay. He's drinking it.
You're going to hear him take a drink hilarious. Real quick.
All right.
Can you tell us a little bit more about that? I mean, is there something known in the industry
he's smelling
about
it.
How Diddy treated his artists? Oh.
So I'm going to get some cheeks after this horsepower joint. I just went off a mixer. Mace took me to Biggie. I don't really know.
I'm about to get some cheeks after this.
after drinking this whore.
This sex stimulant drink.
Like Mason O'Pup. So I appreciate what Mace said. And of course, that's my brother. So if he felt that way, then he felt that way. I can't really tell you how Puff moves or anything like that. Mace may know better than me because he was signed to Puff. I wasn't.
All right.
Wait, hold on.
The show does come on at 8 a.m. Eastern on YouTube. It's called It Is What It Is. Y'all make sure y'all check it out. I mean, I might get some more information out of Mace from there. But for me to tell you how Puff acted and all that, I don't know. I never was signed to him.
Yeah. What about the industry in general? I mean, so many people have pointed out that Diddy couldn't get away with this stuff if there weren't a lot of people protecting him. Do you think that's the case?
Who the talent agent for this joint? Like, you think I'd be sitting around watching what Diddy do and all this? I didn't know this was a Diddy joint that invited me to. Yo, who booked me for this joint?
I'm sitting around watching Diddy and all that. Let's talk about his podcast while he drinks his cheeks afterwards. I gotta get some cheeks after this.
Funniest interview I've heard in a long time.
Who booked me for this?
I think it became clear to him that they were not going to ask him about his drink or his podcast. So he's just like, well, I'll just drink some of it here. Make sure I hold the can up to the camera.
He totally did.
Do you want to hear anything from Drake Bell is speaking out?
Not the Drake I'm thinking of right now, but yeah, definitely.
Drake Bell continues to be interviewed about being abused by a former dialogue coach named Brian Peck. No relation to the to Josh Peck, who was on Josh and Drake, or Drake and Josh. Drake says that Peck was pen pals with serial killer John Wayne Gacy.
What?
Yeah, he brings up a few creepy things here about this Brian Peck, who supposedly abuse Drake.
What's happening to you? As there's a painting hanging on the wall that was painted by John Wayne Gacy. It said, "From your good friend John Wayne Gacy," on the back of this painting. And things are happening to me in a room where there's a painting by one of the most prolific serial killers who preyed on young boys staring at me. So now that puts into my mind, how far is this really going to go? What is really going on in this person's mind?
This was also covered up in the follow-up to the docuseries, Quiet on the Set. Drake Bell opened up on why he is sharing his story of abuse.
Things were spiraling out of control personally and mentally, and I thought, you know, maybe this could help in the healing process and also help others who have gone through the same situations or similar situations.
The documentary that he's talking about is Quiet on Set, which revealed a lot of secrets and abuse at Nickelodeon shows during the 90s. And finally, Drake Bell gave his side of the story after he was accused of sharing explicit messages with a 15-year-old. You remember Drake Bell got in some trouble a couple of years back?
Mm-hmm.
So he talks about that. He shared explicit messages with a 15-year-old fan and why he pleaded guilty to the charges.
There were some messages that shouldn't have been exchanged.
Is that why you pled guilty?
And that's why I pled guilty. But once the age was revealed, that's when I stopped communication.
Okay. Let's take a break. We've got a lot coming up on the show today, including singer-songwriter Don McLean, Barry Kirch, the drummer from Shinedown, and much more for your Tuesday morning right after this.
Double G here. Coming up after the Buzz Adams Morning Show at 10, feature double shots throughout the day.
Centers may increase bleeding. Doctor about all planned medical or dental procedures. Learn more at Eliquis.com or call 1-855-ELIQUIS.
Live from the KLAQ studios, the Buzz Adams Morning Show. Courtesy of Glashine, Vias, and Enderman personal injury lawyers.
At GVILaw.com.
It's It's going to be warm again today, 95 for the high temperature. In fact, mid-90s kind of looks like where we're going to be for high temperatures this week, including through the weekend and Memorial Day on Monday. No rain in the forecast, though. A lot of sunshine, so look for a lot of sun. Some winds in the afternoon, too. That's part of the forecast. Today, sunny, 95. Very similar forecast for the remainder of the week. I'm going to have a true crime report headed your way in just a few minutes. Joanna has the Hollywood Chisme coming up before too long as well. Got a few things to tell you about before we get to our Mo Show calendar and daily almanac of events. Actor Jeff Daniels says that he was worried that one scene in Dumb and Dumber would end his acting career. Do you remember Dumb and Dumber well enough to guess which scene it might have been?
Yeah, I've seen the
story. I've
read the story, okay. Yeah.
Hey, Nico.
Hey.
Actor Jeff Daniels is saying that there was one scene in Dumb and Dumber that he was really worried might end his career.
His pooping scene.
Yes, it is the toilet scene
from
Dumb and Dumber. Had you seen the story as well?
No. Just the most famous, embarrassing scene I could think of.
When Jeff Daniels was in Dumb and Dumber, he had already been in Terms of Endearment, which I think won an Academy Award.
He was a legit
year.
Actor.
Yeah, he was in Speed. So going into filming, he knew he had to go all in. And he says that Jim Carrey encouraged him to really throw himself into the toilet scene in Dumb and Dumber. For those of you who don't remember or never saw Dumb and Dumber, I have the toilet scene.
Thank you.
I hope you had your breakfast.
Good morning, everybody.
I'm so sorry, everyone.
I'm having breakfast.
Felt like I owed it to the listeners.
But it's a visual gag. It's not even an audio gag.
There's a lot of audio.
I mean, that
little
fart at the end is funny.
Jeff Daniels says doing the scene made him nervous because he thought it could be a potential career killer. He says, quote, Jim Carrey, who is fearless, told me it's going to be great. You've just got to go all the way with it. That was a couple of hours of porcelain gymnastics. And that up close, that close up on my red face, I had been doing it so long I had almost passed out. I did my job beyond my job. That scene will probably outlive us. It will still be funny 40 years from now. Jeff Daniels mentioned in a previous interview that he had heard from Clint Eastwood that Clint was a big fan of that, of the toilet scene from Dumb and Dumber.
You know, you have a very respectable body of work, but that toilet scene.
Chef's kiss.
Chef kiss.
Johnny Knoxville is being sued for tasing a former producer on the set of Prank Panel.
Dear.
I think I need to bring up the thing you sent me yesterday. Let me open...
What thing?
The thing you sent me in the Skype. I've never seen the show Prank Panel.
Oh! Yeah, so Denise, that's funny.
If you're working on a show with
Johnny Knoxville,
the main guy from Jackass, and the show is called Prank Panel, I think you go in with slightly different expectations than what you would expect if you went to work for Lehman Brothers, you know, for instance.
Wait, if he's successful, does that mean I could sue you guys for tasing me?
What's this, you guys? Buzz is the one that tased you, not me.
Yeah, could I sue Buzz? No, you're safe, Joanna.
Well, you consented to it before I did.
Did I?
Mm-hmm. There's like a 5-hour loop of your tasing on YouTube.
Yeah, somebody just...
I gotta find it because it's hilarious.
Let's see. Here you go. This is, so what kind of pranks do they do on Prank Panel?
Funny ones?
Yeah. So this is actress Gabourey Sidibe.
Oh, precious.
Yeah, she is. She was. She was precious.
She is and precious. Was.
So see if you notice what the prank is, okay?
Okay. Bitch, is this cake?
No, it's
I was
not.
Like, no, this
oh,
is
it's cake. Cake. Plan to prank you today.
The reaction she has always gets me laughing.
Is this cake?
Is this cake? Is this cake?
Let's go ahead and get to our Mo Show calendar and daily almanac of events. Today is National Waiter and Waitress Day, so let's do a tribute.
Hello there. Hello. Welcome.
Welcome back.
Hi. Are you my waiter?
Are you my waiter?
Where are my waitresses?
Waitress.
Waitress.
Yep. You are a waitress.
Waiter. A waiter.
Today is National Waiter and Waitress Day.
But I prefer the term.
We prefer the term server.
What about tips? I make my living on tips.
Well, tips not included.
Tip is not included.
Showtime.
What is the... I guess we'll get back to this in a second, but it is National Waitstaff Day. Today is also International Tea Day, so spill some tea.
Yeah, drink it, spill it.
Today is also World Chardonnay Day. A few birthdays. Judge Reinhold, who was in Beverly Hills Cop, and Fast Times at Ridgemont High, and the Santa Claus movies. Judge Reinhold is 67 today.
Love him.
Wow.
The singer, Gautier, is 44.
No, I used to know him.
Somebody That I Used to Know was his big hit. That's right. Also, Mr. T is having a birthday. In addition to playing B.A. Baracus on the A-Team, he also was Clubber Lang in Rocky III.
Were you a fan of him in the A-Team?
I had a poster.
Mr. T?
I was such a fan of Mr. T in the 80s.
Can't you see like, Buzz's bedroom, Joanna, with like a Mr. T?
Yeah.
I can picture it perfectly to this day. I would have been too embarrassed to put up like a Farrah Fawcett or a Cheryl Teague poster or something like that.
Oh, because your parents.
Yeah, but.
But they were totally cool with Mr. T.
Yeah, I think I had an Archie Manning poster and an Indiana Jones poster in my room. But that Mr. T was kind of like the centerpiece. Mr. T is 72 today. And Al Franken, former Saturday Night Live writer and cast member and former senator from Minnesota, Al Franken turned 73 today. A few dates in history. Red Cross was founded in 1881 by Clara Barton. It is the birthday for the American Red Cross. 143 years ago it was founded. In 1901, this was 123 years ago, Connecticut became the first state to impose a speed limit for cars. Do you want to hear what the speed limit was when they first approved a speed limit?
Please.
Well, in the city, you couldn't go faster than 12 miles an hour. But out on the country, you could really open her up and get up to 15 miles an hour if you were on
People
the
must
country.
Have been going so slow back then.
I don't know how fast the cars in 1901. I think that could have been approaching top speed, though.
That was fast for them.
They could never have made Speed the movie back then. If you do not keep this car above 15 miles per hour,
it only goes 16.
It will explode.
This is a... Here's just something to remind you of how crazy things were in the 90s. In 1994, Marion Barry announced that he would run for mayor of Washington, D.C. He had already served as the mayor of Washington, D.C., but had done a 3-year jail sentence for possessing and smoking crack. It was caught on a security video, and he was with a lady of the evening when it happened.
Oh.
He won. So after getting caught smoking crack with a hooker on camera and doing 3.5 years in prison for it, he won and was reelected mayor of Washington, D.C. Let's go back to National Waitstaff Day. So I heard in that opening, I heard a few things there. I heard waiters, waitress. I heard that they prefer to be called servers. Does anybody know?
No, I think that's a different. Servers and hostesses are different positions.
No, servers, your waiter. I'll be your server this evening. You've seen that before, at least in TV shows. Hi, I'm Justin. I'll be your server this evening. Can I start you off with, right?
I don't know.
Joanna, do you have any insight? What do waiters and waitresses want to be called?
I guess servers, yeah.
Server, to me, almost sounds like a step servant. Backwards. Yeah, because it sounds so much like servant.
Yeah, it does sound weird. Right?
Did you ever work one of those jobs, Joanna?
No.
Yeah, neither have I.
All I ever did was deliver pizza. So that's the closest I ever came to it.
In honor of National Waitstaff Day, here is your waitstaff translator. Here's what they say.
Would you like anything off the menu to start?
And here's what they mean.
Your order sucks.
What they say.
Oh, that table is reserved for another party.
What they mean.
I don't want you to move because then I'll have to reset the table.
What waiters and waitresses say.
I'm sorry your food is taking so long. It's on the way.
What waiters and waitresses mean.
I forgot to turn your order in.
What they say.
Can I get you anything else today?
What they mean.
I'd like to make more money. Get out now.
And there is your waitstaff translator. Happy National Waitstaff Day.
The Buzz Adams Morning Show, Monday through Friday, 5.
For free. That's LU.com, code 205. To save 15% today. LUMEdeodorant.com.
Oh, guess who this is?
Buzz Adams and the KLAQ Morning Show.
You must be the greatest radio show host ever.
Buzz is back.
All right, I've got a good news, that's not correct at all.
No?
Maybe I'm planning a good news, bad news for later today, but what I have ready to come up right now is a true crime report.
Woo!
So we've got that on the way.
Hey.
Hey, you.
How are you doing today?
I'm good.
We have a neckline call. I don't know if you want to play those.
Which one did you have in mind?
It's the most recent one from... You know, I'm not sure whether to trust the names that come in.
Yeah, right.
Is your audition
not
working?
Do you guys want to
hear
something funny?
Yes.
Here we go.
Hey, bet. Okay.
All right.
Darn it.
I'm going to count three, and then I'm going to do it, okay? One. Oh! Oh, serious.
That's when you tased me.
And now that Johnny Knoxville is being sued by a producer for tasing him?
Do you think I could make any money off of suing you?
No, I don't even think it's worth looking into.
Really?
Mm-mm.
Yeah, you willingly went into this. There's a video.
One.
Right. You know, that doesn't sound willing at all. Hey, I have it. If you want to pop me up.
All right, go ahead.
Hey, good morning, morning show. Good morning, Nico. I heard you took a day off for mental health and...
Okay, I did not take a day off for mental health. Everybody who's listening right now, I was sick yesterday.
There's no shame in that.
Regular sick, there is no shame, but that's not why I called in. But you, Buzz made that up. I didn't say anything like that.
What it was.
Why would you assume that's what it was?
Because Buzz made it sound very convincing. He was like, Nico was very sad.
Oh my God, you are such a douchebag.
Nico came by.
It didn't help that later on you messaged me a picture of your haircut.
Well, because I had heard that's all you talked about yesterday.
Nico went and shaved his head like Britney did when she was having her nervous breakdown.
What are you talking about? I went on
Did you get a car with an umbrella?
We talked about having a haircut on Friday. I went to get a haircut, right?
Hey, good morning, morning show. Good morning, Nico. I heard you took a day off for mental health, and, you know, I think we need it, too. Honestly, I just thought that you got confused and you thought that the holiday weekend was this Monday. But, I just want to apologize for all the calls that I may or may not have made with jokes about your hair on the neckline. So
I don't care.
I mean, I understand, and it's workplace bullying.
I mean, kind of.
You know, you have every right to feel that way. I mean, I'm overweight, and one time I went into work, right? And one of the guys looks at me. He rubs my belly. He's like, hey, man, you got to go to the restroom more often. So, I mean, I understand how you're feeling right there, getting bullied by Buzz and Joanna. But, you know, keep at it, bro. And love the show. See you guys. Have a good week.
See how he included Joanna in the bullying?
I don't think I bully you. All I asked you yesterday was like, oh my God, you shaved your beautiful curls.
Derek sent in a picture. Anyways. And he says he reminds you of that guy in that one movie. That's with your haircut.
That guy in that one movie.
Yeah, the boy in the striped pajamas. There you go.
See, that's workplace bullying.
Yeah, that...
I can tell
that's you... That's just anti-Semitic workplace bullying.
Also that, too.
Nico does not look like the boy in the striped pajamas. He's not wearing striped pajamas.
I make fun of my hair in my own stand-up set. Like, I have tons of bald jokes. Already, there's nothing that Buzz could ever say to me that would make me sad enough to need to take the day off.
Well, he made it sound like you did need the day off.
Oh, I did need the day off, but not for that.
Mm-hmm. For mental health.
Yeah, not for mental health. Not for mental health.
No shame, Nico.
But it wasn't.
Time for our true crime report, actual crime stories from around the world and across the nation.
Any of you involved in any illegal activity? Because I could sure go for some.
We have a variety of stories today. First of all, a man in, this isn't going to be a Florida man game, but it could be. A man in Florida threatened bartenders with a gun because he didn't want the bar to close.
Oh.
39-year-old man in Florida, Carlton Lacey is the man, was at a bar last Saturday night, and at 2 a.m., the bartenders announced that they were closing, which you would know if you've ever been in a bar before.
A bar does, yes.
You don't have to go home, but you can't stay here. Mr. Lacey, the 39-year-old man, was not happy that they were closing the bar. He pulled a gun on one of the bartenders and shouted, "Who needs to leave? Everyone, dude, it's 2 o'clock.
They're all like, you and everyone else.
This is a bar, not the Hotel California. Where you can check out anytime you like.
But you can never leave.
Well, Mr. Lacey continued waving the gun around. A second bartender stepped in. That must have been very courageous. And Lacey pointed the gun at her and said, "Keep playing with me, B-word." Police were called, but by the time they'd gotten there, the man had left. But they tracked him down. He was charged with 2 counts of aggravated assault, also resisting arrest, and possession of a weapon by a convicted felon. So.
Oh.
We should not be surprised that this guy already had a record. A park visitor is in trouble. A park visitor to Disney World in Orlando. So I guess this is another Florida story.
Oh.
A woman in her 60s grabbed a handful of Goofy's buns at Disney World. I'm not talking about baked goods either. The Orange County Sheriff in Florida has confirmed an incident at Disney World where a woman in her 60s touched Goofy inappropriately.
Oh, no.
The 32-year-old male cast member who was playing Goofy was taking pictures with a family of four. Three of them on the right side, and the woman who was the grandmother of the children on his left.
Uh-oh.
So, you know, Goofy's in there. According to the police report, the grandmother placed her hand on Goofy's butt and squeezed three times.
Three times?
That's not all. According to the police report, while squeezing, she said, "Woohoo!" Well, the guy in the Goofy costume was not going to let this slide and reported the woman.
Of course not.
The grandmother was approached by park officials, and she said, "I guess he doesn't want us here. Goofy wants us to leave now."
Yeah, because you're going around groping Goofy.
Gorge.
Gorge.
The father, maybe knowingly, so maybe this was his mother or his mother-in-law, but the father said, "What did you do?" As if it, you know, like she gets in trouble a lot.
Right. Now, what did you do?
It is unclear whether or not they were asked to leave. No arrests have been made. The victim, that is the guy in the Goofy costume, told police he does want to press charges, though.
Not the place that you want
to... With your grandkids right there, right? And you're just going to grab Goofy's buttocks. Do people forget that there are people inside those costumes? I know that's supposed to be the illusion for the children, but for the grown-ups, you know there's a human, there's somebody in there.
You kind of get into this thing where you're like, I'm at Disneyland. You forget someone's in there.
You just get excited?
Yeah. But also, keep your hands to yourself.
Next thing you know, you got Cousin Greg puking inside his mascot mask.
If you know, you know.
drunk driver, he's in trouble for being a drunk driver, but he's in trouble for more than that. A drunk driver got pulled over in Rock Rapids, Iowa, a week ago Sunday. Police say they observed his 2016 Ford Focus swerving all over the road. He was not focusing in that focus, it seems like. When he handed them his ID, the police suspected it was fake. The reason they suspected it was a fake ID was because it listed his height as being 8 feet tall. The driver, 33-year-old Joel Vieda, is actually 5'8", so not even close to 8 feet tall. By the way, the tallest living person in the world right now is 8'3". Mr. Vieda failed a sobriety test and failed the breathalyzer, too. He also had an open beer in his cup holder and a six-pack of Corona in the back seat.
Oh, man. He just keeps going.
Wouldn't that have been a five-pack of Corona if he's got one in the cup holder?
Good point, yeah.
They also found a folded $1 bill with white powder in it that he admitted was... Care to guess?
Okay.
Meth!
Oh, God.
So the police figured out it was a fake ID because he's not 8 foot tall. Turns out the man needed the fake ID because he doesn't have a driver's license and was wanted for not appearing in court for a previous drunk driving charge.
Fake one.
Yeah, it was fake.
And of all the things, he decided, I'm going to put that I'm 8 feet tall here. That's like what
Why would you? That's like McLovin.
That's like when McLovin went and chose McLovin.
One name? McLovin?
Who are you, Seal?
I don't have any experience with fake IDs. I know that people get them, but... Like, wouldn't you want to make it so that it kind of matches your appearance? Or what's the point?
I was too scared to get one.
Afraid to get in trouble?
Yeah, I'm like...
Weren't more afraid to get in trouble with cops or with your parents?
With my mom. Yeah,
of course. Our next story is from Canada. I told you we sometimes have international stories here. Not very often. A teenage driver in Canada got a cell phone ticket... But he says he got it while he was in line at the McDonald's drive-thru, and he was using the McDonald's loyalty app so that he could get free food.
Oh, my God. He's all, I need the app.
Here is
to
the,
get my points.
Here is the Canadian teenager, Mason Prima, talking about getting the ticket in line at McDonald's.
Barely even moving, I'm just rolling. And I go like this to open up my McDonald's app. And I look in my rearview mirror, and there's a motorcycle cop behind me. Show him, I'm like, I'm on my McDonald's app. I'm loading up the code right now to get a free meal. I did think he was just going to let me go, because I'm just trying to get a free meal. Turns out to be a very expensive lunch.
I think the, yeah, he had to pay a fine of $580 for being on his phone. Once again, in line at McDonald's using their loyalty app.
Right. And sometimes on the McDonald's app, if you order online and go pick it up through the drive-thru, it makes you give like a code. So you could confirm that that's your order.
So at some point you would have to.
Yeah.
At some point you'd have to pull out your phone, right?
Yes. Oh my God, that's terrible.
This sounds awful. Two people were arrested in Seattle last week after one of them was caught by police walking out of a store with the cash register. The video shows the woman carrying the cash register right out of the store. It just so happened they walked right into a police officer. It looks like they were outside. It says pharmacy, but it really looks like the exterior of a Walgreens.
Okay.
Here's some of the audio.
Whoa. Hey, doing nothing. Whoa, whoa, hey.
Yes.
Hey, put that down.
Yes.
Hey, hands behind your back. Right. Hands behind your back right now.
So the woman was arrested. I'm not sure if the man was arrested as an accomplice, but there was somebody running out from the pharmacy behind them, so apparently.
Hey, get back here with that cash register.
Let's see. One final story here, Joanna, and it has to do with tacos.
Tacos.
There is now, in the United States at least, a court precedent that tacos are actually sandwiches.
The hell they are.
A judge in Indiana just ruled on a case this week that establishes that tacos are sandwiches. A man named Martin.
I'm sorry, where?
Indiana. You know, the birthplace of the taco.
Yeah, the official authority on tacos.
I think that's a good point. It's like, wait a second, we're gonna let somebody in Indiana decide what tacos are? A man named Martin Quintana has been trying to open a taco place in a strip mall in Fort Wayne.
Okay.
He ran into some red tape thanks to a contract that limits the type of restaurants that are allowed.
Okay.
I guess that's the thing. It claims that you can only open a restaurant that sells made-to-order or Subway-style sandwiches. So Mr. Quintana, the guy who wanted to go into business, sued, claiming tacos and also burritos are sandwiches.
Why not just argue that they're made to order?
I think it was made to order or made to order style sandwiches or Subway. You're right. I think that's
saying.
What they're saying.
I get you.
I don't know if I agree with it.
Yeah, right.
Also, if there's no taco or burrito place, let him open one. It doesn't sound like he's going to be competing with the Subway-style restaurant that's already there.
Yeah. How many Subways could there be there? You need a taco place at least. Even things out.
In Indiana?
Yeah.
His case made its way through the Indiana legal system, and a Superior Court judge ruled last Monday that, yes, tacos are sandwiches.
I guess a victory, a win is a win. A win is a win.
They say there could still be an appeal. The next judge might disagree.
Who's going to appeal the tacos?
But the judge in Indiana ruled that tacos and burritos are basically just, and I'm going to read a direct quote here, Mexican-style sandwiches. Agree?
All right.
Disagree. Or just, like, if it gets him to...
There, yes.
Right. If he is able to bring a bunch of Hoosiers delicious tacos and burritos, then I'm all for it, too.
I'm going to eat a lot of tacos de carne asada.
Yeah.
I'm going to eat some more tacos.
question has been answered by the ultimate taco authority. No, I do not want to. The state of Indiana. I just want
tacos de pollo. Hey, it's Chuck, your host for Loudwire Nights. Tonight at 7, we will rock the borderland with the best rock ever made and the best rock being made. Special guests, birthday and anniversary celebrations, and every night at 10.
So hurry in.
Broadcasting from El Paso for El Paso. The Buzz Adams Morning Show on 95.5 KLAQ.
Joanna has the Hollywood Cheese May coming up in a moment. We've got a few neckline calls I wanted to get to. A lot of people wanting to call in and give Nico words of encouragement following his mental health day off yesterday.
Are we just going to call? Are you going to just keep calling it a mental health day? Because that's not necessarily what it was. I guess it was, but not for the hair.
What was it for?
All the other things I have to deal with you about.
Oh, so it was a mental health day.
It was a mental health day.
Because of things said on the radio.
No, nothing is said on the radio. Everything off air has to do with me dealing with Buzz.
Yeah, I made that up that it was a mental health day, but I could have been right. There's, you know.
You're not wrong.
It was a sick day. But I guess that could be a mental health day. Here's the telephone numbers to call his neckline. You can call anytime, 24 hours a day, and leave a message. That number is 844-805-NECK, 844-805-6325. You can call us in the studio, and if you do give us a direct call in the studio, you get to go first. Studio line number is 915-910-4995. Let's pick up a couple of calls here.
Hey, what's up, guys? This is Larry Kanyonga. Nico, I saw some products on Facebook that might help grow out your hair.
Oh.
I don't know. Maybe you should try them out. All right. Bye, guys.
Oh. Well, what's the product? Let me know.
Do you want me to make you some rosemary water? They say that helps.
Yeah. I hear all... So people have been sending me suggestions.
I had to use some of that because remember I had COVID and I told you I was losing my hair.
Oh, yeah. But it's different for girls because you don't have like male pattern baldness. But I could see, yeah. So you know, I heard castor oil. Someone was like, put castor oil on.
Have you tried anything like that?
No. Some people have given me all kinds of different things. From what the rose water that you were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
What else? People have suggested some plugs.
Have you ever thought, you know, we could just be on the verge, and we don't know about it, but on the verge of a breakthrough in hair restoration science.
We're like 1 week away. Before the cure is there.
Holding out for that.
Well, I think if they cured balding, they would make more money than if they cured a real disease.
Because but you're waiting for like the Viagra for male pattern baldness.
You know, Viagra.
Like a real breakthrough. That was a newsworthy story.
Oh, yeah. When they cured erectile dysfunction, which,
everything else was a bunch of hooey.
Which, by the way, not the biggest, most pressing problem in the world.
Well, you say that, wait until your it doesn't get hard anymore.
I mean, even then
it might not be pressing to you.
It's not gonna kill you.
It's something passionate for Buzz.
Yeah, so look this was like, a big deal for some of us. It's not gonna kill you to not get it fixed. And yet it made $1 billion. I think one of the first drugs to make a $1 billion blockbuster.
They
like
used
that.
To advertise all kinds of hokey stuff in the back of men's magazines, like as boner pills.
Yeah.
And, of course, it was all...
Hooey.
Yeah, it was all hooey. And then when
Spanish
Pfizer
fly,
came
you ever take Spanish Fly?
No, but I used to see those ads in the back of Soldier of Fortune magazines and stuff.
You ever eat oysters? A lot of oysters for it?
Is that supposed to be an aphrodisiac?
On Golden Girls, Blanche tries to give a guy smoked oysters and says it helps. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, good morning, guys. Hey, Nico. I just wanted to send you a big hug and stuff, you know, show you. And then taking a break for mental health. Keep it up, brother. Keep it up. So now I'll give you a call. My ex boss, he went to Chihuahua City. There's some good implants, hair implants. I don't know, maybe, you know, we can talk it out if that's, that might work for you, you know? Don't give up. We all love you, man. We love you. Take care. Bye, guys. Have a good day.
that makes me feel very good, nice. Actually. Yeah, that was super, super nice. Don't give up. Like, I'm going to... Like, this is the one straw. This is the straw. It's like, nope, not going to fix it. Goodbye, guys. I'm taking off.
Nico. Hey, man. Hey, there's a story in the Bible saying that, some kids were making fun of him as bald man. And God took his wrath on these kids and sent two bears to, like, eat them all.
Good.
You know?
Yeah.
So you start seeing a bunch of kids running around, you know, and a couple of bears trying eating them. Hey, you know God has your back, man. All right. Just wanted to let you know. So don't feel bad.
Oh, thank Later. You.
That is nice.
Are you surprised to hear there was a story in the Bible where some people made some kids?
I
made
thought
fun
he
of
made this up.
No, this is an absolutely in the Bible story.
So then, balding has been an issue since days of the Bible.
Days of yore. Yeah.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. People have been bald. For all of human history.
And making fun of them for
it. People have been bullied because of it.
I can't wait to see you chased by a bear, Buzz. Like, I honestly. I mean, you're chased by a lot of bears. On Grindr, at least.
I could be mistaken for a bear. Do you want to hear the story from the Bible real quick?
I kind of do.
It's from the book of 2 Kings, okay?
And did you just look it up?
It's about the prophet Elijah. No, I'm doing this all from memory. In 2 Kings chapter 2, it says, it's talking about Elijah. Then he went up from there to Bethel, which is what they called Bethlehem back in Old Testament.
Right.
He went up to Bethel, and as he was going up, by the way, young lads came out from the city and mocked him and said to him, "Go up, you bald head. Go up, you bald head." Probably a sick burn.
Sick
burn.
Testament
that times. Was a sick burn.
Ugh, I hate these kids.
When he looked behind him, we're talking about Elijah here, and saw them, he cursed them in the name of the Lord. Then two female bears came out of the woods and tore up 42 lads of their number.
Yeah!
I like how they like state female bears.
Go Bears! You see that, kids? You see what happens?
See what happens? A bear gonna get you.
Lord works in mysterious ways.
The Lord is on our side.
Alright, let's go ahead. The Bible is full. I am totally full of
crazy stories
that I
want to hear.
They don't really dwell on it in church because then you gotta explain why God would kill 42 children for making fun of a bald man, and it's easier just done to tell that story in church.
It's the Hollywood Cheese Man. It's the Hollywood Cheese Man. Joanna, tell us more.
It's Joanna Barba with today's Hollywood Cheese May. Good morning, Joanna.
Oh, hey, good morning. Rolling Stone got together with Kid Rock for a new feature that asks how he, quote, went from America's favorite hard-partying rock star to a MAGA mouthpiece. And it's a lot. It questions whether Kid's hard right turn and incorporation of politics into his music and his stage show are sincere or a commercial move. But toward the end of the interview, things get kind of dark as a totally wasted Kid Rock waves a gun around, uses the N-word multiple times, and complains about, quote, black women having children they can't afford. Another example describes the end of a tense interaction that says, quote, from the writer, after another 5 or 10 minutes of this back and forth, he finally seems to lose steam and agrees to drive me back to my car. As he pours himself one more drink for the road, he looks up and down and says, do you think you could whoop the S out of me? He asks.
Do you think you could
whoop the crap out of me?
Oh, man.
I laugh. Probably not. You can take a shot if you want. No, thanks. I'm good. As the Rolling Stone reporter is leaving, Kid Rock also tells him, would you do me a favor? Just write the most horrific article about me. Do it. It helps me. And continues with, I walk toward my car, and just before I get to it, he calls out one more time, will you tell everyone that I was halfway cool? What is going on with Kid Rock?
This is getting pretty sad, but...
I mean, he's adult rock at some point,
Let's
right?
go back to he said the N-word several times during the interview.
And complained about, quote, black women having children they can't afford.
No, I would say he's pretty sincerely MAGA based on that.
I think he's kind of like, I found my people.
The writer also said, the guy who interviewed Kid Rock said that Kid Rock wanted him to stay the night.
Oh, God.
Oh, my God, imagine.
Hey, come spend the night with me. Who would say yes to spending the night with Kid Rock?
Right.
Pamela Anderson.
Yeah, that's a good point. Okay.
But waving a gun around, drinking.
N-word.
The N-word. I mean, it's kind of like a bingo card.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Can't wait till that comes out. AMC isn't clowning around when it comes to Goodfellas. Back in 2020, the network added a trigger warning to the film, warning viewers that, quote, this film includes language and or cultural stereotypes that are inconsistent with today's standards of inclusion and tolerance and may offend some viewers. But the disclaimer only recently went viral after former New York Post reporter Kevin Lovett tweeted out, now I've seen it all, AMC message before the classic film Goodfellas. An AMC rep told the Post, quote, in 2020, we began adding warnings in front of certain films that include racial or cultural references that some viewers might find offensive. Many actors and directors have spoken out against trigger warnings being attached to films, including Cate Blanchett, who told the Sunday Times, quotes, we are terrified of tough conversations, but we need them. We talk about radical candor, but when there's a trigger warning in front of something, you are implying that there's a lack of mutual respect or that there's a subject that hasn't been properly interrogated.
Huh. So they didn't like pointing out that the mafia is mostly made up of Italian guys, huh? is that what the problem was?
What I find it weird is that this has been going on since 2020 and people are barely discovering, like, there's a trigger warning in front of this movie. But it's been happening since 2020. Scarlett
Johansson. They even talk, in The Sopranos, they talk about it. Like, Tony Soprano in some scenes is bitching and moaning about the way Italians get portrayed in movies and television.
Oh, really?
That's interesting.
Like some kind of stereotype. Meanwhile, he's whacking guys. And he's got a gumara on the side.
He's ordering gabagool all the time.
Yeah, the gabagool. His boat is called the Stugats.
Never saw The Sopranos. Sorry about that. Scarlett Johansson said that she turned down OpenAI's request for her to lend her voice to a conversational ChatGPT system and that she was shocked and angered that the company went ahead and used a voice that sounded very similar to hers anyway. Johansson, in a statement provided to Variety, said her lawyers contacted OpenAI to have the voice of Sky, one of the new voices in the GPT-4o chatbot, pulled down. OpenAI last week introduced the Sky voice, which sounded very much like Johansson's disembodied AI companion in Spike Jonze's 2013 movie, Her, in a demo of GPT-4o. The company earlier Monday said it would pause the use of the Sky voice and said, quote, we believe that AI voices should not deliberately mimic a celebrity's distinctive voice. Sky's voice is not an imitation of Scarlett Johansson, but belongs to a different professional actress using her own natural speaking voice.
Hmm. That just happens to sound so much like Scarlett Johansson.
That happens to have that little voice that she has, like this like breathy voice. Johansson said that she had been contacted by OpenAI CEO Sam Altman in September of 2023 about the company hiring her to provide the voice for ChatGPT 4.0. She said that she declined for personal reasons. And finally, Graceland, the historic home of Elvis Presley, is set to be sold off at a foreclosure sale this Thursday, according to a legal notice.
What?
But Presley's granddaughter is fighting the sale with a lawsuit saying the claims are fraudulent. A temporary restraining order on the sale was granted Monday, according to an attorney for Riley Keogh. An injunction hearing is set for Wednesday, and Priscilla Presley, Lisa Marie's mother, wrote on her ex account, it's a scam. A notice published this
Wait a minute. Did Tom Selleck talk them into a reverse mortgage?
It's possible, right? A notice published this Monday states that Graceland and surrounding acreage on Elvis Presley Boulevard is set to be auctioned off for cash to the highest bidder on the Shelby County Courthouse steps May 23rd. The legal notice states that Lisa Marie Presley allegedly signed a deed of trust in 2018, securing a $3.8 million loan with a Missouri company called Nasany Investments and Private Lending, using Graceland as collateral. The company claims that she never paid that money back before she died last year.
So they're going to take Graceland.
So they're like, we're taking Graceland. But Presley's daughter, Riley Keogh, says a 60-page lawsuit against Nasany Investments filed May 15th in a Shelby County court that her mother had never borrowed any money from that company. She also claims that Presley's signatures on the deeds are forgeries and that Nasany Investments is not a real entity. According to the suit, the notary involved in the deed denies that she notarized Lisa Marie Presley's signature or ever met her. So we will see what happens to Graceland.
So Lisa Marie, who passed away, is the one that they're saying signed the thing.
Yes.
Okay.
And so now the granddaughter of Priscilla Presley's, Lisa Marie Presley's daughter, Riley, is saying that they're all forgeries. And now even the notary has come out and said she never even met Lisa Marie Presley.
There's a lot of drama going down.
Who will get Graceland next? With your entertainment news, I'm Joanna Barba.
Hey, so this was official. There'd been signs, but yes, Red Lobster has filed for bankruptcy.
It happened. Endless Shrimp.
They say that one of the promotions that was the nail in the coffin or the straw that broke the camel's back was that Endless Shrimp.
They're like, wow, people really like shrimp.
Red Lobster, the corporation said it had more than $1 billion in debt and less than $30 million in cash on hand. It plans to sell its business to lenders and will continue to close restaurants. We don't know if all of the Red Lobsters are going to be closed, but it looks like they are insolvent.
One day only, it's a Red Lobster fire sale. Everything must go.
You got crabs?
We got crabs.
I love hush puppies.
We got those too.
How about just packs of tartar sauce?
Come on down and stock up.
Shrimp?
We don't have any more shrimp because you gluttons ate all of it during our unlimited shrimp deal, which sent us spiraling into debt to the point the only way we could make ends meet was to close locations and hawk light fixtures for $10 a pop. Which reminds me, you want light fixtures? We got light fixtures. The Red Lobster fire sale. Hurry before we turn into another Raising Cane's.
Oh. Find out what's going on. Quirky facts about our region. Urgent things you need to know impacting your drive. And of course, nothing but El Paso's best rock. Oh, with Dubba G.
Now is always Rudolph. We're located at I-10 and Red Road, the only road, the Rudolph Road.
The Buzz Adams Morning Show, Monday through Friday, 5 to 10. KLEQ and KLEQ HD1, El Paso, a Town Square media station.
We've got a big show today coming up. Drummer for Shinedown, Barry Kirch, is going to be on. And we're going to talk some Shinedown. We're going to talk some world tour.
But we're also
talking about the Shinedown Symptom Chipotle Garlic Sauce. The Shinedown Hot Sauce. And I am not much for hot sauce. Like, if I ever went on Hot Ones and ate all that, you know I would die, right?
You wouldn't make it past the first.
I don't think so.
First one, two.
I don't think I could participate in that.
It's a medical condition at this point.
Oh, man. And I used to like pretty hot stuff, too. Yeah. Not no mo. But I will try it just so the drummer from Shinedown doesn't think I'm a scaredy cat. Also, singer-songwriter, writer of one of the greatest songs of all time, in my opinion, Don McLean, who wrote and recorded American Pie. Don McLean's going to be on with us a little bit later this morning. I'm super, super excited about that.
Here's a bit of trivia for you. In my family, all the men are bald, and all the women have full heads of hair. So that's what I identify with. Men are bald. It's not a bad thing. Bye.
Thank you, Tracy.
My dad was bald. Well, you met my dad.
I did.
That was how his hair was ever since I knew him. Like
that exact same. Those he had little couple strands on top.
Like a couple of strands on top, but a horseshoe and then hair on the side. And a lot of my cousins, my brother is completely chrome dome.
Is he really?
Have you not met him?
No.
Yeah. He shaves it down, you know, to nothing. And most of the men in my family, of course, I was adopted. I must have come from a family of Sasquatches or something because I got so much hair. Oh, I'm sorry. Did that mess with your mental health?
Boys.
I'm sorry.
No, because I'm thin and have a big number, so I'm happy.
Boys.
What's up, y'all? Nico. Buzz said that you're not all there in the mind. You might have mental health issues, whatever.
I said, do you see what you did?
No, I said you took a mental health day because DJ Cooch made fun of your hair.
And was that true?
Well, I thought it was a joke, but you've come in and what you've said to me since then leads me to believe that maybe there was some truth to it.
No, not at all. A mental health day for anything DJ Cooch or you have ever said to me. Maybe sometimes I just need a mental health day from you.
Okay.
Start smoking, maybe some weed. It'll help out, probably.
Okay. I don't know how long you've been listening to the show, sir. But if weed was the answer for everything, Nico would be the most well-adjusted human being on the face of the planet.
Shut up.
I think it will make you relax anyways. And get you, maybe you get hungry, too. Bye.
But play it again from the top.
That's long.
This is the very top.
What's up, y'all? Nico. Buzz said that you're not all there in the mind.
Okay, stop. You have people thinking I'm not all there in the mind, which it's arguable. If I do stand up, I mean, that is something that crazy people decide to do.
I don't think you're mentally ill. I think that, and I don't think you were that upset by what DJ Cooch was saying.
No. No, you can just say anything you want about me, and people will listen.
After the one-day mental health break, Nico's back.
I'm back to tip-top shape, joking.
Hey, somebody called in about the story about the bear in the Old Testament
who
mauled a bunch of kids to death because they made fun of a prophet who was bald.
Which you don't do. You shouldn't make fun of bald people.
Yo, morning show. So you're talking about that biblical story of the prophet Elijah and how the bear killed those 42 lads. So bear in mind, Elijah was a prophet. God used Elijah to slay the prophets of Baal. So he was not a popular guy in Israel. And so imagine him going to a town and there's a gang of 42 hooligans.
It says youths in the Bible. In the King James Version of the Bible, it said they were youths.
And they're menacing and threatening him. That's how I've been taught the story that these 42, that's a pretty big gang.
This always gets me. People say, you know, the Bible is literally true. I believe it's literally true. And then they just add all this stuff to make a weird story seem more normal. I'll read you everything it says.
A 42 lad gang.
And, a 42 lad gang.
And, they were mocking him, but it was more than just mocking. They were menacing and threatening him and harassing him. So,
you know, hold on a second. Let me check. The King James Version of 2 Kings says, and it's talking about the prophet Elisha. Then he went up there to Bethel, and as he was going up on the road, some youths came from the city and mocked him and said to him, "Go up, you bald head. Go up, you bald head.
You bastards."
So he turned around and looked at them and pronounced a curse on them in the name of the Lord. and two female bears came out of the woods and mauled 42 of the youth.
Yeah, get them.
The next verse, and then he went up unto Bethel. As he was going up, that's all it says about the bear incident, just that they called him Baldhead, so he prayed to God to send bears to maul 22 youths. I just love it when people claim the Bible as their source on something and claim to be literalist, and then they just add in all this other stuff. That's why you need to read it yourself. Is it true that Catholics are not encouraged to read the Bible for themselves, Joanna? I've heard that for a long time.
Probably. I've never read the Bible.
Like, at church, they don't tell you, you need to go home and read the Bible?
Oh, yeah. No, they don't tell us.
Wait, who do you think's more Catholic, me or Joanna?
Joanna.
You're Catholic, Nico?
Did you have catechism?
I did, yeah.
Oh, yeah, you're more Catholic than I am.
Did you?
The implication there was an intent to harm him.
The implication there was an intent to harm them. The Bible is full of these crazy stories that don't make any sense. But if they do teach him, it's always like, well, what really happened was he was jumped by a gang of guys and they were actually going to hurt him and the bears came out.
God said, nah, that ain't going to happen. Let me send a couple of she-bears to rip these hooligans, the Edgars of their day. Let me rip these hooligans to pieces. So, God is gracious and kind, but don't get on his bad side. Yeah. Because he is a wrathful God also.
Yeah. Don't make fun of somebody for having a bald head when you're a kid, or God will send bears to kill you.
She-bears.
He's both. He's a loving, kind God, and he's a wrathful God.
Okay.
Oh, my God, I want to be called a she-bear.
Yeah, I grew up hearing this kind of double talk every Sunday. Every time I would come up with a good question, what about dinosaurs? Uh-huh. Those bones were put there by the devil, as far as we know, to fool people into thinking that God didn't create the earth.
What about penguins?
In our app chat, 5 points guy says, day number 765 of talking about Nico's baldness. Next bet Buzz loses, he's shaving his head.
I am not shaving my head. I'm worried that if I did, it would permanently affect it.
How about this? Let's put a button in my baldness right now, because I think we have talked about it enough.
Okay.
I did not have a mental health day for balding yesterday. I have accepted it. I have shaved my head. It's going to grow back. And it will look just as bald in a couple of weeks.
I'll make you rosemary water.
I've done this before.
Okay.
It's grown back.
Tempting fate is all I'm saying.
Until then.
It's ODG. Joanna?
Yes.
Oh, girl, baby girl. Don't even play. Buzz, with your bleached, built butch body. Nico, with your curly Q. Gallagher hair.
Not anymore.
Oh, girl, baby girl could be a song, man. Oh, girl, baby girl. Oh, girl, baby girl.
Yeah. AOC's people need to get on that.
So this is ODG making fun of the verbal attack that went down between Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene, who definitely started it, Jasmine Crockett, then AOC got pulled into it somehow.
So embarrassing. And
John Fetterman had said, he sent out a tweet that said, you know, in the past I had said the House of Representatives operates like the Jerry Springer Show. Today I want to take the opportunity to apologize to the Jerry Springer Show. And AOC got all bent down.
She did.
Yeah. Yeah, she called him out for not standing up for fellow Democrats, and, you know, Fetterman's a Democrat.
Yeah, but I don't think AOC, and I don't think Jasmine Crockett, I'm sure you're going to play this right now, but I don't think they realize it's not playing.
When you get down to wallow in the mud with a pig, you're no different from the pig.
You get dirty.
That's right.
Baby girl. I mean, AOC and... I know it was MTG, but Lauren Boebert was there. AOC and Lauren Boebert are hot, man. They could both get it. We could have a bipartisan orgy.
Okay. Good Lord, ODG.
That reminds me. Someone in the after, I was like, did ODG say that he thought Lauren Boebert was hot? Let him know Beetlejuice is coming to El Paso.
She is
sometimes
really
pretty. I do think she is hot.
She's pretty.
Like, she's okay. Never been hotter than walking after she got kicked out of Beetlejuice and she's walking and she out. It's like, God, I didn't know.
And then
she's
like adjusting her dress. I and her know. Boobs.
She's got a lot of a blouse full of goodies.
Beetlejuice
going on
is coming to town, guys.
So I don't think this includes AOC. She was the one who was like, girl. Baby girl.
Oh,
I don't think this clip includes that part.
Do you know what we're here for? I don't think you know what you're here for.
Well, you're the one talking about. I
think your fake eyelashes are messing up.
No, ain't nothing.
Hold on. Order.
I'm just curious, just to better understand your ruling. If someone on this committee then starts talking about somebody's bleach blonde, bad built butch body, that would not be engaging in personalities, correct?
Okay, so right there, Jasmine Crockett had been talked to in a demeaning way by Marjorie Taylor Greene, and she had time to sit there and think, and she could have thought of a way to rise above it or to put herself in the superior position. But instead, she spent that time coming up with a quintuple alliterative insult. So, yeah, I think that everybody who got involved in this looks bad, and it makes all of us look bad by association.
What now?
that's the best part, though. The best part, that's James Comer.
Comer sounds
like the dad that's trying to control his two teenage daughters that are fighting
and
with
does
that.
Not understand what they're fighting about.
That would not be engaging in personalities, correct?
What now?
Chairman, I make a motion to strike those words.
I don't think that's
hold
a
on. We're not gonna do this. Look, you guys,
you just voted to do
it.
I'm trying to get clarification. Look, it, calm down.
Look, I don't know if you noticed it. I have two hearing aids. I'm very deaf. I'm not understanding. Everybody's yelling. I'm doing the best I can.
Please,
that's a dad right there.
Yeah.
Stop!
I don't understand what either one of you are talking about.
I'm going to call your mom.
I will pull this Congress right over.
So,
can I say this now? Both Marjorie Taylor Greene and Jasmine Crockett are fundraising off of this.
Oh, you using it as motivation?
Jasmine Crockett has made T-shirts with what she said back, and she has now called it her Jasmine Clapbacks.
The bad...
Or the Crockett clapback.
What was it? Bleach blonde, bad built, butch body.
I'm going to get Buzz a shirt that says that.
I don't think she realizes that by trying to capitalize on it and
it just makes you...
It makes her look very small. And now you look kind of like MTG.
Remember what Michelle Oh said. When they go low, we go high.
You get high.
And AOC and Jasmine Crockett both did not go high. Maybe they got high later.
Coming to NBC, don't miss the stand-up comedy competition you've been waiting for. Marjorie Taylor Greene and Jasmine Crockett compete in Last Congresswoman Standing.
I would like to ask the gentle lady from Texas, who colors her hair, Stevie Wonder?
I would ask my colleague from across the aisle if it's true that you're so ugly that when you joined an ugly contest, they said, sorry, no professionals.
Marjorie Taylor Greene and Jasmine Crockett bring the house down in the roast battle to end all roast battles.
Girl, you are a goatee away from being Matthew McConaughey.
Oh, yeah? How can you even see me through those fake eyelashes?
It's Last Congresswoman Standing, coming to NBC.
Take a quick break here. Coming up, Nico Ajimian news headlines on the way next.
A group of Tesla investors are fighting against Elon Musk and his pay package. All the details next in news.
While you're working away, we're working for you. Our job starting at
2. Come and see me at Vida's 901 North Mesa or visit www.vida-cbd.com.
Broadcasting in El Paso to El Paso. The Buzz Adams Morning Show on 95.5 KLAQ.
Okay, let's hear it.
It begins.
And the weather's good.
coming up later on the morning show. Drummer for Shinedown, Barry Kirch, is going to be on talking about Shinedown summer plans and also the Shinedown Chipotle garlic hot sauce that's available now. And then later, singer-songwriter Don McLean, whose biggest hit was American Pie, is going to be on to talk. He's got new music. And I'm frankly very excited to talk to Don McLean. Nico, let's go ahead and get to our news headlines before we do anything else, though. Good morning.
Good morning, Buzz. Good morning, Joanna.
Good morning.
Iranian President Ebrahim Raisi and the country's foreign minister were found dead Monday, hours after their helicopter crashed in fog, leaving the Islamic Republic without two key leaders as extraordinary tensions grip the wider Middle East. Supreme Leader Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, who has the final say in the Shiite theocracy, quickly named a little-known vice president as caretaker and insisted the government was in control. But the deaths mark yet another blow to a country beset by pressures both at home and abroad. Iran has offered no cause for the crash, nor suggested sabotage brought down the helicopter, which fell in mountainous terrain in a sudden, intense fog. But
It probably sounds suspicious to people, but these were the Iranians that went to go investigate it. I mean, if they had any inkling that it was Israel or had anything to do with Israel's allies that did this, they'd be shouting that from the rooftops, right?
I don't think so, because I think that would signal that
they're
weak and they weren't able to protect. So it could still be sabotage. The container.
Well, it'd be a good way if they could credibly claim that Israel
they wouldn't be able
and the
to prove
States
it.
Had
they,
anything
they,
to
they
do.
Might be able to know it, but not be able to prove it. Do you know what I mean? Like they might have signals intelligence and like spy reports, but they're not going to publish spy reports.
You let UN investigators go in, or you even let American investigators go in?
I'm not even
sure
they're part of the UN, are they?
No, but still, I mean, this was a big enough issue that So I think that if they could connect Israel or the U.S. to this in any way, it'd get them a lot of sympathy from unaffiliated countries.
If they had.
But I don't think. I mean, proof. What I'm saying is, since the Iranians are saying that it was just an accident, then it probably is just an accident.
I disagree.
What, you don't think it was an accident?
Personally?
Yeah.
No.
You think somebody brought down the helicopter and the Iranians are covering it up?
I absolutely do not believe the Iranians would publicize their security faults and the fact that they were unable to secure their president.
Able to secure their president even if it was an accident. That's a security fault that you were in a helicopter that crashed. I mean, that doesn't reflect well.
I think that sounds better than, we weren't good enough to stop these spies from taking it down. The container ship that caused the deadly collapse at Baltimore's Francis Scott Key Bridge was refloated yesterday and has begun slowly moving back to port. The Dali has remained at the collapse site since it lost power and crashed into one of the bridge's support columns on March 26th, killing six construction workers and snarling traffic into Baltimore Harbor. The ship appeared to start moving shortly Monday morning after 6 a.m. local time as crews started to maneuver it out of the wreckage. Pieces of the bridge's steel trusses protruded from its bow, which remained covered in concrete from the collapsed roadway. The all-important channel to the port of Baltimore is expected to fully reopen to commercial marine traffic by the end of this month. The threat posed by artificial intelligence programs is real and creates a serious challenge going into the 2024 election. That's according to a new federal assessment. The analysis compiled by the Department of Homeland Security and obtained by ABC News outlines how, with less than 6 months before Election Day, next-generation technologies meant to fuel advancement also offer opportunities for misuse that could threaten the democratic system's bedrock of elections. As the 2024 election cycle progresses, generative AI tools likely provide both domestic and foreign threat actors with enhanced opportunities for interference by aggravating emerging events, disrupting election processes, or attacking election infrastructure, the May 17th document has said. Those tools, the bulletin also says, can be wielded to influence and sow discord in upcoming U.S. elections by those who view them as attractive and priority targets.
I just know that this story is about AI, and I just got a call about AI.
Oh, okay.
It's from Who does the AI Trump and Biden?
That's our 5 points guy.
That 5 points guy.
Yeah.
Okay. It's 5 points guy.
Hey, good morning, you guys. So the app I use to do Donald and Biden, it's no longer working. I've been trying it since Monday. Mm. Yesterday, I had a few calls. I wanted to do skits. I wanted to kick out to you guys, but not working. So I'm going to have to use another AI app. I'm glad I only paid for it for a month because it gives you an option to pay for it for a year.
Oh, and no, man.
I was this close to doing it, but I wanted to experiment with another AI app. Also, I did leave a call Friday around the end of the show, like 9:50, 9:55. That one was actually pretty good. But other than that, that's going to be the last call until I can get this app or find a suitable app. Have a good one, guys.
Oh, man. Thank you very much.
We have come to appreciate those so much that I would consider maybe chipping in for the year subscription.
Hey,
so 5 points, guy, you do what you're going to do and experiment, but yeah, I would at least think about chipping in for the AI.
Also, did you hear how he sounded sad because
we didn't play the thing on Friday?
Well, yeah, and he's done a lot. Like, he has a lot of.
No, I know, and I
we can't get to them all.
Late, and we just can't get.
We can't get to them all. I'm sorry, 5 points, guy. And yeah, sometimes they get lost.
Gosh,
there's just so many messages. Sometimes
I don't know how you guys keep up with all these messages.
Not well, apparently.
I'm not doing well with these.
Right now, I'm trying to find. 5 points, guys. Call from Friday. I would love to hear it.
Keep looking for it while I move on. More than 800,000 people have fled Rafah in the past 2 weeks amid Israel's ongoing military operation in the southern Gaza city, according to the United Nations Relief and Work Agency for Palestine Refugees, or UNRWA. Every time families are displaced, their lives are at serious risk. People are forced to leave everything behind looking for safety, but there is no safe zone, UNRWA said on their social media platform X yesterday.
Still have not found the call from Friday.
After a busy, eventful day, the prosecution rested its case against former President Donald Trump yesterday in the hush money case that alleges he committed fraud to hide payments to adult film star Stormy Daniels. After the testimony of former Trump fixer Michael Cohen was finished yesterday, the prosecution rested its case. The defense called its first two witnesses, which included lawyer Robert Costello, a witness that became problematic for the proceedings. Costello's testimony included claims that his association with Cohen led him to believe that Trump didn't know about the payments to Daniels. However, when he began muttering to himself on the stand and commenting on objections, Judge Juan Merchan cleared the courtroom of jurors and reporters to discuss proper decorum in my courtroom, quote unquote.
The guy's a lawyer. I think the guy had been a federal prosecutor, Costello, we're talking about.
He is also a huge Donald Trump advocate, and I believe he's like head on cable news a lot.
Okay. But he knows what courtroom decorum is supposed to be.
Yeah, but I'm sure he was trying to, you know.
Curry favor.
Yeah.
The boss is sitting there watching you on the stand.
Yeah. The defense also made a motion to dismiss the case, saying that the prosecution had failed to prove that business records were falsified, the basis for the case. Judge Merchan said he will wait to decide on Trump attorney Todd Blanche's motion to dismiss. And the White House announced yesterday that the chairman of the Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, or FDIC, will be stepping down. Martin Gruenberg will be leaving the position once a successor is appointed, and President Joe Biden will reportedly name a replacement soon. While Republicans have been highlighting the alleged misconduct by Gruenberg's agency members, no Democrat had called for him to leave the position until yesterday. Senator Sherrod Brown, the top Democrat on the Senate Banking Committee, issued a statement calling for Gruenberg to step down. During a congressional committee hearing, here is Senator Tim Scott talking about the FDIC chairman.
The level of intimidation that is embedded in the culture after a decade of your leadership, you can't just unravel it. You can't unscramble that egg. You've heard me say this to you directly. You should resign.
The FDIC chair was grilled for 2 days last week in congressional hearings that mostly focused on the workplace culture at the agency, which Senator John Kennedy said came from as many as 500 of the FDIC's 6,000 employees. Here is Senator John Kennedy.
The Me Too movement reminded us all that America is no place for creepy old men who sexually harass and demean their employees.
So I guess conservative Republicans and even those in the MAGA side of things, now they think the Me Too movement's a good thing? Did they all along?
Well, so I think the FDIC position, and Republicans have had problems with these kind of independent commissions for a while now. That's why you hear a lot of Republican outrage, and it gives them a talking point.
Is that even a political appointment, or is that?
I believe it might be, but it doesn't. It might be longer than, it might be like 6 years.
Well,
or something.
Just remember,
sure.
FDIC spells FDIC, so these must have been FDIC pictures that were being sent around. Did I nail it that time?
That one was better. It was a little bit better.
Good morning, Buzz. This is El Triple Cooler calling in. The entire time I've been in court, there's been an artist painting these amazing portraits of me. I am certain he is going to be the Picasso of our time. I'm sure these paintings of me are going to sell for billions. And I want a percentage so that I can pay my court fees. I sure wish I had a city-issued gas card so I don't have to waste my money driving to court every day. And also to pay off some more adult film stars, just in case any more come forward. Oh, wait, that's how I got into this mess.
Those are getting better. That was even better.
That was maybe the best one yet, as far as sounding.
Sounding quality-wise.
Right. Yeah, so 5 points. If you're listening, we need to talk. I could definitely, I think I am committing to at least helping pay for your AI.
A report released last week by law firm Cleary Gottlieb Steen and Hamilton cited incidents of stalking, harassment, homophobia, and other violations of employment regulations by senior members of the FDIC.
There's not supposed to be a carve-out for bigots and perverts at the FDIC to harass their coworkers when they're supposed to be regulating America's banks.
The complaints included a female field examiner who said she received a picture of an FDIC senior examiner's private parts or an FDIC pic.
My joke.
Mine. I was about to do it better.
I need to stop stumbling over each other like that. I need a recycler.
I was about to do it better than you did.
Go ahead. Try it again. I'll remain silent.
There you go. The complaints included a female field examiner who said she received a picture of an FDIC senior examiner's private parts, or an FDIC pic.
Nice.
There you go. See?
8:33.
Yeah, I'm not convinced it's that strong of a joke.
The show's not over. We still got time to get another.
Oh, but yeah, we still have another show. And another woman said she had been stalked.
It's good to hear that John Kennedy, the senator from Louisiana, doesn't think that there should be a carve out for what did he say? Perverts,
creepy old
perverts.
Yes.
At the FDIC. I hope John Kennedy thinks that applies to the White House as well. But something tells me he doesn't.
Yeah, I agree. All right. Big news. There is legislation being introduced to keep AM radios in vehicles.
This is great news for Steve Kaplan. From our partner station, 600 ESPN El Paso.
Steve, this is going to save you.
Do you realize how that would kill the entire AM side if they didn't put them in new cars?
In any cars anymore.
Yeah, that would be just the end of the death knell for AM radio.
New Jersey Democratic Congressman Frank Pallone and Republican Florida Representative Gus Brilsrakis introduced the AM radio for every vehicle act of 2024 yesterday. It would require vehicle manufacturers to include AM broadcast radio as standard equipment in new vehicles. The legislation argues that AM radio is a tool needed for emergencies and has been a good source for news, entertainment, sports, and music for scores of drivers for decades. Are you looking this up now?
I am just saying I don't know what I would do without my... Let's see, what do we have?
What if they said this about FM radio? Would that be the end of FM radio?
Oh, my God.
Yeah, yeah. If they stop putting FM radios standard in new vehicles,
yeah,
that would be a real setback. Because you would have to then expect people to either bring up their phone or take an actual transistor radio with them.
Yeah.
But notice how Buzz says they have to bring up their phone like it's such a foreign concept.
Yeah, as if people aren't just putting on Spotify. Yeah,
I bet you, right. No, I bet you most of the
people right now
that
are like, all right, that's enough for the morning show to Spotify.
I will say that when I
listen to us on their phone is what I mean.
That's a good point, too.
Yeah. Also, when the aux cord is broken or other parts, like the radio, sometimes the only... Oh, yeah, I guess I have to listen to the radio now.
We work in radio. Dude.
No, we love the radio.
That's great, yeah.
I did not realize how many AM stations there were and how many of them are like Christian stations.
Oh, really?
Like 90%?
KXPL AM 1260 is a news talk Spanish. Did you know that?
Hey, I'm sure Joanna knows this. Tell everybody else who's listening how if you're west of the Rocky Mountains or something, you're K.
Yeah, your station call letters start with K.
And
if you're east of the Mississippi, it's the river. Yeah, the east of the Mississippi. So west of the Mississippi River, you're KLAQ. If you're east of the Mississippi, you're WKRP in Cincinnati.
I thought that was fascinating.
Or WJFK is a station in New York. Yeah. There are some exceptions. Like there's one in... I think it's Pittsburgh, which is east of the Mississippi, that starts with a K, and that's because it was like the first radio station.
Just a couple more stories left. Police are searching for a man who allegedly broke into a house in San Diego and then started removing his clothes and then asking for Bibles. The incident happened early Sunday morning. The homeowner, identified as Carol, was home with her 92-year-old mother and says that after confronting the man and asking him to leave, he began rambling about looking for friends. When she stepped away to get some Bibles, the man began stripping down.
Wait, so she was going to get the man his Bibles?
Yes. When cops arrived, the intruder slipped out of the house and took off and is still at large.
Did he take the Bibles with him?
Good question. A group of Tesla investors is urging shareholders to vote against CEO Elon Musk's $56 billion pay package. The group issued an open letter yesterday criticizing the package as against Tesla's interests, arguing the company's board has failed to rein in Musk, including his fights with regulators and controversial public statements. That, they say, has led to a decline in the electric automaker's reputation and has had a negative effect on the bottom line. The vote is scheduled for June 13th.
All right.
And... finally, Red Lobster is filing for bankruptcy.
Yeah, I heard something about that. Don't know if there are going to be any Red Lobsters left after this all gets sorted out because they're selling some of the restaurants.
Pretty
they're closing down some of the restaurants.
Especially in Texas. The Florida-based casual dining giant filed for voluntary Chapter 11 bankruptcy, but plans to remain open even as it closes locations across the U.S. The popular chain had previously announced plans to close 99 locations as it deals with its financial problems.
Hey, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Like, with this going on, it's been going on for a couple months, and I think the writing was on the wall that Red Lobster was going to declare bankruptcy.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard a lot of people talking about it being garbage food or not good. Am I out of touch? I always like Red Lobster. That's a real treat, man, when you get those Cheddar Bay biscuits.
Hell yeah, them Cheddar
thank
Bay
you.
Biscuits are thank
you.
Okay,
can baby I say- girl, thank you.
I like Red Lobster, but I would not consider it fancy food.
Well, I know it's not really fancy, but it's fancier than.
I think people try and make it seem fancy, or at least Red Lobster does.
Well, for some people, it is fancy.
Yeah, okay.
Definitely for some people.
Yeah.
Take me on a first date to Red Lobster. We're making out at the end.
I mean, for me, Cafe Central is a once every 5 years type. I've really got to be, you know, trying to accomplish something. I must really be trying to get somewhere if I go to Cafe Central.
The blame is being put on major missteps by management, including they're choosing to make endless shrimp permanent.
They should have learned from Endless Crab.
Yeah.
This happened five years. Endless Crab, and you did it
they
again
like,
with
okay,
Endless Shrimp.
We screwed up with the Endless Crab. Let's go
do it with shrimp.
Different.
Fool you once, mm-hmm. shame on me. Fool you twice, guys. Shame on
the
you.
Shame is- still on me.
Hungry? Then come on down to Bankruptcy Fest at In the Red Lobster, where our new stripped-down menu is full of surprises.
Welcome to In the Red Lobster. Can I get you started off
in
with something to drink?
Sure, I'll have a Diet Coke.
Water it is. Would you like an appetizer?
Oh, sure.
Too bad. What would you like as your entree?
Well, I've really been in the mood for grilled shrimp skewers, so...
Yeah, I bet. One bologna sandwich coming up.
Huh?
It's Bankruptcy Fest, only at In the Red Lobster.
Do you at least have all-you-can-eat shrimp?
No, but I can give you all-you-can-eat cocktail sauce.
Going on now until we close down, which could be tomorrow.
Hey, it's Double G. Coming up after the Buzz Adams Morning Show.
A meal with the best gal in town, Madre Rosa. She'll have you coming back for more just outside of the outlet mall.
Live from the KLAQ studios, the Buzz Adams Morning Show. Courtesy of Glashine, Vias, and Enderman personal injury lawyers. At GVILaw.com.
Coming up, Barry Karch, who is the drummer and the original drummer for Shinedown, is going to be on. We'll be talking about Shinedown, their plans for the summer, but also the Shinedown Symptom Chipotle Garlic Sauce, their hot sauce.
Have you tried it yet?
I haven't. I think it'll be a thing if it's really hot, or I can try it one time
and not
go to the hospital, but I think beyond that, I'm pressing my luck.
I think we should all try it right before.
I think we should try it with him on. I think he'd appreciate that.
Yeah.
Joanna, what's my rule with phone calls? Do you recall?
Like live phone
calls? Live phone calls go on first.
Straight, yes, they go first. Right.
If you call into the studio and that number is 915-910-4995, you get to go first. So here is Art. Hello, Art.
Hey.
Good morning, guys.
Hey, what's up, Art?
I have an interesting nugget here in regards to... call letters for TV stations.
Oh, cool. You got a nug?
A nug. So, you're right. You know, east of the Mississippi is W, west is K. But do you guys know this? That all of your W's for the three of the four major networks, NBC, ABC, and CBS, are in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
And the K's are in L.A.
Yeah, that's right.
But
WABC.
That's not true for the Foxes. That's not true for Fox.
Oh.
You guys know what K Fox is?
El Paso. If you're talking about just straight up KFOX, that's El Paso's Fox affiliate.
Right. I just always thought it was interesting that the three ABC, CBS, and NBC, they're all in LA or New York.
Yeah. Well,
but
those are legacy, though.
W Fox is. Yeah.
Yeah. Fox as a network was kind of a.
Jacksonville, too, so.
Huh. Fox as a network, though, was really a Johnny come lately. I mean, these other networks had been around for 70 years before KFOX. But I am impressed that an El Paso station was able to lock that down.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we have a KFOX. I mean, I don't want to talk about the competition, although they.
Right.
But they're KFOX, but it's not KFOX. They're something else, and I can't recall what they are. KOFX, maybe? Yeah. All right. Okay. Thanks, Art.
No, you're welcome. Thanks.
All right. Appreciate the call.
I do like knowing that. I like the little tidbits.
I like when people call in with, like, I have a little nug.
Yeah. I love nugs.
Yeah.
Bring them on.
I think there's a station in Dallas that starts with a W. And I guess that has to do with there's an exception to every rule. You know, it should be K, because Dallas is west of the Mississippi. I think they have one AM station there that's a W.
WFAT?
No, but I always wanted to name, if I had my own station, I was going to name it KOTX and call it Bloody Good Radio.
KOTX. TX. Mm-hmm. Oh, like...
like Kotex.
Hey, thanks for stopping at our pad.
And you know,
how do you like your rock today? Mini or maxi?
The first time you said that joke.
What?
I've said that joke before.
I've used it as a recycler. I'm going to find it.
Don't use it as a recycler again.
Morning, Mo Show. Hey, Joanna, you said that if we take you to eat at Red Lobster, we'll be making out at the end. I'll pick you up at 11. We'll do lunch. All right. Have a great day. Bye.
Lunch at Red Lobster? Hell yeah.
Did you say that?
What?
That if somebody took you to Red Lobster, you're definitely making out with them?
Yes.
I missed that.
Well, I think we have another call from the same caller.
What, on the neckline?
Yeah.
Good morning, Mo Show. Good morning, Buzz. Good morning, Nico.
Good morning.
Good morning, Joanna.
Hello.
Am I the only one that caught that Nico mentioned he had a big member? What's that all about? Anyways, another show. Great day. And Nico. Nico's bald. Nico's bald. All right. Love you guys. Bye.
Interesting that Nico chose to play the call about his purported member.
Oh, you know what? I guess I did make that decision.
Why did you bring that up?
Because it was the same caller. And honestly, I didn't know what we were talking about at the time.
Yo, morning show. Since we're talking about creepy old perverts, what about Joe Biden? Mm. Yeah, I'm sure you've seen that footage where he goes behind little girls and grabs them by the shoulder so they can't get away. And he sniffs their hair. And he whispers things into their ears. That guy is creepy. Creepy Joe.
They talked him out of doing it. You notice he doesn't do it anymore. Mm-hmm. Somebody had to sit down with him and said, look, this might have flown 50 or 60 years ago, but it doesn't anymore. It just looks super creepy. And if you're going to be the president, they should have told him a long time ago.
Yeah. Can I mention something?
Yeah.
Okay, first of all,
Joe Biden, I not convicted by a civil jury of rape, basically. Yeah.
Donald Trump is essentially a convicted rapist. I find it like old grandfatherly creepy. Like, do you remember presidents used to kiss babies?
Yeah, that was even, you got to go out there and shake hands and kiss babies.
Imagine.
Or, which works better than kissing hands and shaking babies.
Yes, it was much better. But that's the kind of age of politics that Biden comes from. Imagine today if somebody was going around and kissing babies. Like, would you would automatically start saying the same stuff. You'd say, that guy's creepy. That guy's a pedophile.
I don't want to make too many excuses because obviously what he was doing did rub people the wrong way. And they talked to him and convinced him.
Stop doing the creepy old man stuff.
The creep. And how about that autobiography his daughter did where she said, he would barge into her, the shower, into the bathroom while she's taking a shower?
I've never heard of that before. I mean,
And what's the context? Like, yeah, he barged in to, like, remind her to go to school? Or
I'd need to know what the context of that was.
That's creepy. Creepy, snippy Joe. All right, morning show. You have a good day. Bye-bye.
We used to have a guy, everybody loved him, older guy at our church. And after church, the little kids would gather around because he always brought candy, you know, like butterscotch candy or caramels or something. And listen, I'm not suggesting anything creepy here, but looking back on it, he would often have you feel around in his pockets, like which pocket is it in to find the thing, in full view of every member of the church, including everybody's parents.
It was just, hey,
this is the most beloved old man in church because he gives the kids candy. It's times have changed, but I just want to mention before you talk about Joe Biden, that picture of Trump and Epstein checking out a bunch of young chicks dancing where they were the only dudes there. So,
Joanna, what if you saw a guy running for something and he was kissing babies?
Like on their forehead or?
Doesn't matter.
Anywhere like, but the lips.
Give me your baby and I'll give it a kiss.
Yeah.
I think there's like a lot of things now where you're like, don't kiss a baby.
Don't kiss babies.
Babies you don't know, yeah.
Don't ask kids to go through your pockets looking for candy.
Hey, good morning again, guys. Hey, you know what I just wanted to mention right away? Big Daddy Delicious, we're slowly seeing a character development arc with every time that he calls in.
I think that was the guy who called himself Big Daddy Delicious.
before you guys, he gave himself that name, Big Daddy Delicious. We didn't know, well, at least I didn't know much about him, but now I get the feeling that he is a Christian, conservative, and he kind of buys into conspiracy theories and a globalist. So
I would agree with that.
I'm listening for that plot to see where this goes.
All right, guys. The plot will develop.
See where the development of Big Daddy Delicious goes.
Nice.
All right.
Hey, it's Daniel Palas. I'll be along starting at 3 with everything from GNR to STP.
Or online. It includes factory rebate and dealer discount plus TTNL. Also, like vehicles with approved credit, offers not combined.
The Buzz Adams Morning Show, Monday through Friday, 5 to 10. KLEQ and KLEQ HD1, El Paso, a Town Square media station.
Shinedown is, I guess their tour starts
today?
Let me find out if that's right. We got Barry Kirsch, the drummer from Shinedown, and I've got some of his hot sauce here, too. Hi, Barry.
Good morning.
How are you?
Barry, am I right? Is your summer tour starting tonight?
Starts this week. I have rehearsals tonight, and I believe let's see, tomorrow's Wednesday, Thursday, Friday's the show.
Friday, okay.
I lose track.
today, Brent and Zach are playing at the Grammy Hall of Fame Gala. Okay, that's why I thought there was a Shinedown show tonight, but I'm trying to see. I'm not seeing anything in Texas. I'm trying to find geographically the closest point to where we are.
It's not very close, but I think probably the closest would be the Alabama show later this year.
No, man, we're all the way on the other side of Texas. It's like...
There's nothing, I think, near...
Concho, Oklahoma. I'm from Oklahoma. I'm not sure where Concho is, but that's got to be like a casino or something, right?
I think so. I just go where they tell me to go.
Yeah, right? Yeah, just point me in the direction, and I will play music.
Also,
I don't book the shows. I play the shows.
Yeah. anyway, Shinedown is going to be out on tour. Are you guys going international at any point this year?
Not this year. This is kind of a light year for tour. We're doing some of these festivals and some one-offs and things like that, but most of this year is concerned with whatever the next Shinedown 8 record is going to be, so we're writing and recording a lot this year to hopefully have something out by this late winter or early next year.
Well, the current album, the one with Symptom of Being Human, it just feels really current to me. You know, I guess you're touring in support of that album.
Yeah, Planet Zero. But, you know, it's almost been out for 2 years now.
It's hard to believe. It really doesn't.
But I think with the success of Symptom of Being Human, the song and all that, it seems like we're still riding this one high, and we are, so...
That's
why we're doing the shows we're doing.
The hot sauce is named after Symptom of Being Human. It's Shinedown Symptom Chipotle Garlic Sauce. And I...
Barry, we got to talk about the hot sauce.
Yeah, something happened to me a couple of years ago. I used to love spicy food. And then it's just something internally. It's really hard for me to handle. But because I don't want you to think... I don't want Barry Kirch to think I'm a wuss. I'm going to try some of it. Is it like extreme heat, or how would you describe it?
No. So what I wanted to do when we came up with the sauce and we worked on making the sauce, we actually made 3 that are going to be released in succession, but this is the first one. We wanted the first one to come out to not be super spicy. We wanted it for the masses. We wanted it for people like yourself that can't handle too much. It has a little kick. It is a hot sauce. But, this, you know, even my 13-year-old daughter, who doesn't really like spicy foods, really enjoys this one. And we wanted, you know, just like Symptom of Being Human is a song about all of us, we wanted this sauce to be all for everyone. So that's why it's named after the song.
All right. I'm going to smear some on a cracker. I know that's probably not the best thing to eat it on, but just
something to palate.
That's a good way to say it. It's a judgment-free zone here.
And I think Joanna and I are going to just do it straight.
I'm just going to go for it. Yeah.
Should we do it now?
Yeah.
Yeah, just do it now. Barry, I got to ask, why hot sauce? What made you guys think of hot sauce?
I've always been into hot sauces ever since I was a little kid. I'm crazy about them. I've made my own at home my whole life. I still grow peppers and make my own hot sauces stuff.
Okay.
Half my fridge is full of hot sauces. So,
cool.
When Torchbearer approached the label and said, hey, would any of your artists want to collaborate with us? Because Torchbearer has been around for about 20 years, and they make wonderful hot sauces, and they enjoy doing collaborations. I raised my hand and said, absolutely. And what was nice about it, it wasn't, okay, here's a hot sauce, put your name on it. We actually got in the trenches, talked about it, and worked on it for probably about 5-6 months to come up with the three sauces that we ended up coming up with. So it was definitely a hands-on thing, and it was a lot of fun.
I want to talk a little bit about the process of making delicious, the hot sauce. But first of all, I want to try my cracker with Symptom Chipotle garlic sauce.
There's a hush across the room.
Mm-hmm. I really love that the garlic is super prominent.
It's actually kind of sweet. There comes the fire. I felt it. I thought it's just sweet. No, there's a little
fire.
It is
a hot sauce.
It is a hot. It's not a cool sauce.
No, the garlic tastes real good.
Yeah, I really like that garlic.
This would be good on wings.
I was just going to tell you, Barry, I'm going to do your symptom challenge. You have a list of four things people can do. Creating fun videos and stuff, and I'm gonna make the hot wings.
Oh yeah, make those.
Please
wings.
Do.
Yeah,
please do. And if you go to, I think we might have sent some to you guys, but if you go to shinedown.com, the merch section where we're selling the sauce, there is some recipes that I wrote for my kitchen.
Oh, cool.
With this sauce, one of them being a wing recipe. So there's wing recipe, there's a gumbo recipe, charboiled oyster recipe. Oh, all of those are from my house.
Charboiled oyster sounds great. So I want to, Barry Kirch, who's been the drummer, I think, like from day one with Shinedown, right, Barry?
Correct.
Yeah. Yes. And pepper grower.
And pepper and renowned pepper horticulturalist.
Correct.
Got his own hot sauce. And I've got a friend who does a radio show in Virginia, and he was telling me, he said, you ought to do this. I got my hot sauce, and they're actually carrying it on the local grocery stores. And I said, really? You don't even work in that big a market. And he said, oh, it all comes from one plant. They just stick different labels on it.
Oh, that's one of those, yeah. That's not what we wanted to do.
That is not, okay. And I was like, wait a minute, are all of these hot? I still have a Metallica beer that I will never open because it's a Metallica beer, but I don't know. You know, do they just slap the same label on different celebrity hot sauce?
Made over at Anheuser-Busch? I don't know.
Yeah. But you guys.
For us, we actually got into it. I helped curate these recipes with Vid, who's the guy over at Torchbearer Hot Sauces. This is a one-of-a-kind hot sauce that we worked on. I would never put Shinedown's name or my name on anything that I wasn't proud of and worked on. Period.
Wow. That's the way I feel. Yeah, good for you, Barry.
Barry, have you seen that show Hot Ones, the wing challenge?
Yes.
Do you think that you'll do something like that? Maybe like a line of just increasingly hotter and hotter and hotter hot sauces?
No, I don't think I will. Not that show is very entertaining, and I know some of Torchbearer sauces have been on that show. Two things with that show is they won't do branded sauces, so like sauces, just that's something they do, which is cool. I respect that. But also, we have three sauces coming out. This is the first of the three. Okay. The other two are a little bit hotter, but as much as I can handle the Trinidad Scorpion and the Carolina Reaper sauces and stuff like that when they have flavor, I don't want to drink mace. You know, I just want to torture myself to that level, nor do I want to torture other people. So, you know, I like to keep it up into the habaneros and right about in there. That's a flavorful
where
sauce.
You can still after taste
that,
it.
It's crazy. Yeah, after that, it's just a challenge. And look, I don't think food is a competition. I don't enjoy it.
I want to let everybody know, I want to report that it started off sweet, then I felt a little fire in the front of my tongue. The fire has now moved back to the back of my tongue, but I will survive. In fact, I would eat wings with the Symptom hot sauce on them for sure.
Yeah, especially with a little ranch or blue cheese, whatever your preference is.
Yeah, it's something to take the heat out a little bit. Yeah.
But are you allowed to tell us the flavors for the next two that you're coming out with?
I assume they're going to be named after Shinedown songs, right?
They'll definitely be related to Shinedown. I will not tell you what the flavors are. That's a surprise.
I think the hottest one should be called Bully.
Trust me, that was on the table.
Hey, let me tell you just a little bit. If you're lucky enough to see Shinedown when they're out touring around, they're playing quite a few dates starting, I think Barry told us Friday is going to be the first date. But I also wanted to say that the song, Symptom of Being Human, which this hot sauce is named after, is really like, you know, it's what's called crossover. They're playing it on top 40 stations as well as rock stations. Mm-hmm. It's a really great song. And, you know, we're playing it, of course. And I thought I'd play a little bit of that on our way out. Barry, thank you very much. Thanks to Torchbearer for sending us the hot sauce.
Yeah, absolutely.
We're definitely going to try a few of the challenges. And if not this year, maybe next year, maybe the year after that, you get to Texas, come out to the far west, and bring some of your hot sauce with you.
We'll be there sooner than you think. And thanks to all of you for the support over the years. I truly appreciate it.
No, thank you for all the great music over the years. Thank you, Barry.
Absolutely. You guys have a good one.
Bye-bye. There is Barry Kirch. So if you see Shinedown playing, Barry is the guy with dreadlocks banging on the drums.
Oh, cool.
That's Barry.
Sometimes I'm in a room where I don't belong, and the house is on fire, and there's no alarm, and the walls are melting too. Being human.
Nice, huh?
Yeah.
Kind of a little slower, a little more ballady than most of Shinedown stuff. It's really cool.
Pack all your baggage, hide it in the attic. Well, you hope it disappears.
And the song hits harder with the hot sauce in my mouth.
Yeah. Hot sauce is good.
It's a vibe.
It is. Make those wings, Ninko.
It's just another unknown. You've always been slightly awkward, kind of weird. Upside down and not all here. Right or wrong, it's all so crystal clear. Sometimes I'm in a room where I don't
belong. Nice song. We got to take a break, though. One of the great singer-songwriters of all time, Don McLean, who for years did not do a lot of interviews. We're going to interview American Pie singer-songwriter Don McLean coming up in just a few moments on the Buzz Adams Morning Show.
Coming up after the Buzz Adams Morning Show, Glenn Garza and Daniel Polis.
Cider Pints and $8 Cider Growl on Saturdays. Your weekly craft beer forecast at the Tin Man. See more on Instagram at Tin Man EP.
Let there be sound. Let the commercials be over. And let there be
the Buzz Adams Morning Show.
Hey, right on, Buzz.
It's showtime. Let's kick some ass.
What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening.
You can tell us what's happening. You can call us in the studio. Let me give out the studio line number. That's 915-910-4995. That's 910-4995. Even if you don't plan on calling in live, have that number handy, because anytime we do a contest, we usually use the studio line number to give away tickets and things like that. Or you can call us on the toll-free neckline anytime you like, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, just by dialing 844-805-NECK. That's 844-805-6325. All right, Joanna.
Yeah.
Before I get too carried away here, you have to remind me, we have a very specific time window.
Yes,
with one of the great songwriters of all time. And I am not exaggerating. Don McLean, who wrote and sang and performed American Pie and Vincent, Starry, Starry Night.
Did you kick out Ninko?
Ninko said that he didn't feel qualified because he doesn't know that much about Don McLean. But Ninko doesn't know much about anything. Right. Having to do with music.
He was like, Buzz kicked me out.
I didn't kick you out. You said you didn't feel like you could really contribute to an interview with Don McLean. What's going on?
I did felt kicked out a little. Mm-hmm. I told you, like...
Are you filming me?
Yeah, what's wrong with that?
Why are you filming me?
Because I'm going to film the Don McLean interview.
He's filming how excited you are for this. By the way, the guy for Barry Rizzo says it went great.
Oh, the guy
loved the interview. Yeah, the guy that coordinated the interview.
Okay. All right, great. Well, we had a good time. It was nice talking to him. You know, some of these guys you don't hear from as much. Like, you hear usually Brent, you know, or maybe one of the other members of the band, but all of these guys have, you know, really interesting people.
I just want to say you turned down all of the questions I wanted to ask Don McLean, so...
What were you, no, you, okay.
I wanted to ask
I don't even want you to say it. I wanted to
ask him what it was like to play with Tom Petty and George Harrison in that supergroup.
Oh. He was not in the Traveling Wilburys, if that's what you're suggesting.
And then I'm all,
I started singing bye-bye, Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Then good old...
Do you know, you can walk into a room... with people in it from age 90, even to my daughter's age, and if they know American Pie, it's that much of a cultural standard. I think, you know what, I'm going to save this for the interview, but Don McLean's coming up. Did you know that he is the guy that Killing Me Softly, the song Killing Me Softly by Roberta Flack was written about?
No way.
What?
Killing me softly with his
song. The dude that was strumming his her pain
strumming
with his fingers?
Strumming my pain with his fingers.
Wait, because they dated?
No. So it's an interesting...
singing her life with his words?
Yes. Do you want to hear the story behind it?
Yes,
absolutely.
Because I need to stall for about 5 minutes. A songwriter, not Roberta Flack. So Roberta Flack recorded it, but she didn't write it. It was a young folk artist who was 20 at the time and went to go see Don McLean perform at the Troubadour in L.A. And he had already had, I think it was right after the American Pie album came out. And she saw him performing, especially a song that was on the American Pie album called Empty Chairs. And then she went and told some songwriters connected to her label, hey, I saw this and I had a few ideas. I jotted a few ideas down. The songwriters took it from there and wrote Killing Me Softly, which this young artist, whose name I can't recall, did a version of, but it was Roberta Flack's version that was the real big hit. And you know how Killing Me Softly goes, right?
Yeah.
Okay, here's the song that Don McLean performed that inspired that song.
I feel a trembling tingle of a sleepless night creep through my fingers and the moon is bright. Beams of blue come flickering through my window pane like gypsy moths that dance around.
What's going on over there?
Why are you giggling?
I'm so excited.
That I never understood.
See, like, he's strumming her pain with his fingers, singing her life with his words,
and
killing her softly.
You look like Will Ferrell and John C. Reilly in Step Brothers when they have so much room for activities.
Well, let me, I think we're hooking up here. So Don McLean has a new song out. Let me make sure. Let me play a little bit of it for you. It's called...
Hey, Buzz, there?
Hey, yes, who am I speaking to?
Can hear us.
Unmute myself.
Buzz.
How often are we going to be going through this? Hello?
Buzz.
Yes, can anybody hear my voice?
We can hear you.
There you go.
Is the legendary, one of my heroes of all time, Don McLean present?
I am here.
Don, I want to play a little bit of American Boys.
Thank you.
Let's listen to this. I was just talking all about how much I love Don McLean, how that, I think that song, American Pie, people will be singing in 200 years. I have no doubt about it. But here's something new from Don McLean.
Yeah, American boys invented rock and roll.
Oh, yeah.
Singing rhythm and blues with a hillbilly song. Shook up the nation. American boys invented rock and roll.
So I want to play some more of it later, but we only have Don McLean for a small window of time. But it name checks a bunch of the early pioneers like Fats Domino and Chuck Berry and Elvis, and it name checks all these guys. So it's, to me, kind of a continuation, because American Pie was all about losing Buddy. Buddy Holly gets mentioned in this new song. So I think the theme is kind of similar to American Pie. Do you agree, Don? Wait, hold it. I have to turn down the music. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Don. You said?
It's the grammar school version of American Pie. American Pie is the college version.
When I said that earlier, I fully expected 200 years, there's still going to be people, if you start singing American Pie, or if it comes on whatever the version of radio is, people are going to know the song and they're going to sing along to it.
There's no telling where artificial intelligence is going to take right? everything. Well, I have a feeling that you're going to be hearing me and everything I ever did in some other weird form out there. And I also have a feeling that this material from all the songwriters are going to be mingled in with so much other stuff. And there's going to be a legal quagmire that's going to be unbelievable with everybody suing everybody. So hopefully they're at the beginning of this, they'll sort some rules out and allow things to happen. Because, you know, once you get that technological thing out of the bottle, you can't put it back in again. And that's just how it's going to be now. And you're not going to know anything, what's real and what isn't. But, you know, I think once you've got songs that are in the mind of people, that you're very much ahead of the game in the music business, because a lot of this stuff comes and goes now, and it's really based more on spectacle, performance, the work these people do. I mean, I couldn't imagine how Taylor Swift does a tour like that with all that set changes and all the stuff she's got to do. I mean, it's incredible.
It seems like you'd be out of breath if nothing else. I mean, not just her, really? But a lot of these people on stage. It seems like you'd have to stop and catch your breath. Yeah.
And that started a long time ago, you know, with Britney Spears and all those people. They started that, and every song became like a live video, you know. Mm-hmm. And boy, you got to carry around all that stuff and set it up, and you got to draw all those people. It's a huge commitment. And it's an amazing undertaking, and you have to take your hat off to anybody that can do this.
I want to, I was at donmclean.com, and people should go check that out, because I learned something important. I had always heard the story, until I believed it, Don McLean, for whatever reason, wouldn't play American Pie in concert. So after hearing a dozen times, I believed it. But according to donmclean.com, here's what it says. Yeah. Don McLean always sings American Pie in concert. Yeah. How did something like that get started?
Yeah, well, I'll tell you how. I was playing at the in upstate New York at a big outdoor venue, and at that time I was news. I would end up on the news almost anywhere that I went. Mm-hmm. This was 72.
Right.
And a guy from Associated Press said, "Are you going to sing American Pie today?" I said, "Oh, no, I'm not going to sing that song," I said, kidding with the guy. Well, he writes a story, says Don McLean doesn't sing the song anymore. I thought to myself, you know, you can't even joke with these people. So I learned a lot of lessons about, you know, how you have to behave when that kind of spotlight is on you. You know, I don't think it made, well, it must have made a difference, because certainly people, you're still asking me about it, you know.
Yeah, right.
All these years later.
Well, what's so disturbing is that it stuck in my head, and I thought, for whatever reason, he doesn't play it. That seems like kind of a jerk thing to do, but now I know the truth.
Well, I am a jerk sometimes. No doubt about that. That's been proven. Hey, but I always play the song because I respect the audience. You see, that kind of comment goes to the essence of how you feel about your audience. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't care enough to sing the most important song that they came to see. I mean, come on. So it says a lot of bad stuff that I would not be guilty of.
Yeah, and I wonder how that continued to, you know, stick around after so many people would say, well, I just saw Don McLean, and he definitely played American Pie in concert.
Well, you know, I had a lot of stuff happen with that song. First of all, it was so big worldwide for so long, and then it got overplayed and overexposed, and there was a kind of a backlash against it, like in 73 and 74. So you had to actually recover from it in a way, and all kinds of things happened. And then I had put out an album called Homeless Brother, which I loved, and it had a song on it called Wonderful Baby, which people started realizing that I just did different things, you know, but that's not the prescription for superstardom. I mean, you're supposed to do the same thing over and over again or something close, you know. And I would not do that. So, you know, I'd go along and then all of a sudden a crying would pop up in 80, 81 and Castles is back on the charts. And so people started, I think, buying the albums more and getting into kind of what it is that I do, which was my goal because I'm not a hit maker. You know, I've made a few that were number ones, but really where there were accidents almost.
Do you plan on touring any this year? Are you going to do shows this year?
Oh yeah, I'm doing random shows. You can go to donmclain.com or you can even put my name in YouTube and you'll see all kinds of stuff.
Don, what was it like making the new record? What was the experience like in a post-COVID world?
Well, I was locked down in the house when I was working on it a lot of times, you know, so I loved that. I didn't have to travel.
We're talking to the one guy who loved COVID.
Yeah, I didn't get it. So what do you think about that?
All right, we're out of time. Thank you, Don McLean. What a pleasure this has been for me.
Thanks.
I really, really appreciate you spending some time with us.
I appreciate your remarks.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, American boys. Yeah. Woo! Invented rock and roll. Singing. Man, they caused a sensation. That shook up the nation. American boys invented rock and roll.
You know, I did not grow up listening to rock or pop music.
But you grew up listening to Don McLean.
No, I did not.
Oh.
I didn't hear American Pie until I was probably like a freshman in college, and at the dorm they had a gym, so you know a bunch of guys would go out and work out.
Yeah,
and they always had a radio on. Well, this song comes on, and it gets to the not this song, but American Pie comes on, and it gets to the point where he says, "I started singing," and everybody in the gym, whether they were in the middle of doing bench presses or squats or whatever, everybody starts going, "Bye, Miss America."
I started singing, "Bye." Miss American Pie. Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Then good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye, singing, "This'll be the day that I die."
Hey, Nico, real quick, I just want to test you. Who sings this song now?
John McLean.
I started singing, "Bye, Miss American Pie." Drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Then good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye. This will be the day that I die. This will be the day that I die.
I'm Daniel Paulus, and whether you're wrapping up your workday,
growth means lower taxes. It's El Paso's time for lower property taxes. I'm Bernard Johnson, and I approve this message.
Live from the KLAQ studios, the Buzz Adams Morning Show. Courtesy of Blasheen, Vias, and Enderman personal injury lawyers.
At gvilaw.com.
Drumming my pain with his fingers, singing my life with his words.
It's a jam.
Why'd you look at her?
Killing me softly with his song.
We just interviewed. We just interviewed the guy this song was about.
Killing my whole life with his words, killing me softly with his song.
Just indulge me for a moment.
When do we not?
Ah, yeah.
A little bossa nova.
Buzz is so... I've never seen Buzz so happy.
Yeah, this is like the best mood he's been in.
That dark cloud that usually follows him isn't there.
I heard he sang a good song.
Beautiful. Good song.
I heard he had a style.
Oh. style.
And so I came to see him to listen for a while. And there he was, this young boy, a stranger to my eyes, drumming my bed with his
ring. You do a good job on this song, Joanna.
Thank you.
Singing my life with his words.
Come on, go.
I can't believe this do is about it.
Don't mess up. Joanna sings this good. Shut up. You just threw her off.
I know. Here,
take it again, Joanna.
Here we go. With his song.
Song.
I can't believe Buzz is still playing it.
I forgot what a good song this was.
I don't know. That's a jam.
Now, do you know bop. This one, or do you know the Fugees
version? I'm more familiar the Fugees. With the Fugees version.
Yeah. Not going to lie, I thought it was a Lauryn Hill song forever.
No, it was a Roberta Flack song, but she didn't even write it.
Amazing.
That's probably the closest I will ever get to speaking to Bob Dylan.
Is... Like the one
you're like two thirds of
yeah,
away.
Yeah, you're
to
two
Bob
degrees
Dylan.
Away.
Let's get a couple of calls going real quick. Then we have the Hollywood Cheese May with Joanna coming up.
How long before they turned the Red Lobsters into those spirit Halloween stuff? You know, a month, a year, who knows?
You know, the spirit Halloween CEOs are just like rubbing their hands together like Mr.
They're
Burns.
Derek reminds us that even though Red Lobster's going away, Red Parrot has endless crabs, too.
Derek job. Sounds a little concerned. He says, Buzz hasn't brought up Scotty Scheffler today.
I feel like I really got it out of my system with Kaplowitz yesterday.
You really did. Nico, you do not know how happy
how much
I was.
Talked.
When Steve finally
oh, showed
in.
Up, because then you didn't have
and
to
I was
talk.
Like, oh, thank God. I don't have to pretend I care about this Scotty Scheffler thing anymore.
Even with everything we talked about yesterday, you're not interested in, you know, the number one golfer in the world who has to be the most even-tempered, you know, even-keeled guy. Even after his round was over, he didn't have a bad word to say about the Louisville police or anything. And he really probably could have... You know, complained about it, but the fact that this guy who's so even keeled was arrested, and he says it was a big misunderstanding on the police. You've got me started again. You've done it again. On the police.
You've done it.
I done did it.
On the police report, the officer who wrote the ticket wrote him up for felony assault.
Mm-hmm.
Scotty Scheffler says he thought he was following as best he could the officer's
instructions.
Right.
See, how do I know these things?
Because some of it has sunk in.
Yeah.
Are you guys watching anything interesting?
I'm watching Franklin on Apple TV Plus, all about Benjamin Franklin.
Oh, right. Not the turtle.
The turtle helping you read?
No, silly.
Franklin helped me learn how to read, so.
Is it
I'm watching
good?
Bridgerton, or I finished watching Bridgerton.
Nice.
You finished season 3?
It's in two parts. The second part doesn't come out until next month.
Joanna,
Stupid show. I love it.
Do you like the history part of it at all?
I don't think there's anything historically accurate.
It's just all banging.
I think
it's just a bunch of smut.
That is an important cool. thing to me. Like for Franklin, I'm learning a lot about Benjamin Franklin.
I'm learning about smut.
My mom was telling me, I tried to get into that Bridgerton, and I just couldn't do it.
That's interesting.
I know.
I
told
three
everyone.
Episodes. Are the first three episodes super randy?
Not Oh, no, yeah, they kind of
I
are.
Thought she would be into it, if anything.
And so I told my whole family, everyone start watching this so we can discuss this at the dinner table. And my mom was like, yeah, I didn't really get into it.
Wait, but I'm sorry, I didn't hear your answer. Have you watched all of the new season? 3, I think?
Yes.
And you're done?
Yeah, and I'm done.
You must have binged that.
It was only like 4 episodes for the 3rd season, and then the 2nd part of it drops next month.
Oh, okay. All right, that makes sense.
But I'm on pins and needles.
I'm watching MASH.
And what are you learning historically about that?
That it was funny to make fun of people in the Korean War.
So is it a good show? Because I remember when MASH would start on Nick at Night, I was like, oh, it's time to go to bed. It's 10 o'clock.
It's actually hilarious.
I learned that in the 1950s in the Army, you could not get kicked out for dressing as a woman.
No. Oh, my God. The costumes these soldiers are in constantly. I'm just going back in time to find old good TV.
If you like history, if you liked the HBO show John Adams that came out a few years ago.
Yes.
Watch Franklin on...
It's Apple Plus?
Apple TV Plus, I think.
Hey, Ben Franklin.
I am John Franklin.
He is a founding father.
He's a representative of the United States.
Played by Michael Douglas.
Michael Douglas.
In our war against England.
Hooking up with ladies.
What?
We both know you have trouble.
He went to France to get their assistance, and they liked him because he put a key on a kite string.
I have it in their heads. I invent electricity.
It's Ben Franklin.
It's the Hollywood cheese man. It's the Hollywood cheese man. Joanna, tell us more.
It's Joanna Barba with today's Hollywood Cheese May. Good morning, Joanna.
Oh, hey, good morning. Rolling Stone got together with Kid Rock for a new feature that asks how he, quote, went from America's favorite hard-partying rock star to a MAGA mouthpiece. And it's a lot. It questions whether Kid's hard right turn and incorporation of politics into his music and his stage show are sincere or a commercial move. But toward the end of the interview, things get kind of dark as a totally wasted Kid Rock waves a gun around, uses the N-word multiple times, and complains about, quote, black women having children they can't afford. Another example describes the end of a tense interaction that says, quote, from the writer, After another 5 or 10 minutes of this back and forth, he finally seems to lose steam and agrees to drive me back to my car. As he pours himself one more drink for the road, he looks up and down and says, do you think you could whoop the S out of me? He asks.
Do you think you could
whoop the crap out of me?
Oh, man.
I laugh. Probably not. You can take a shot if you want. No, thanks. I'm good. As the Rolling Stone reporter is leaving, Kid Rock also tells him, would you do me a favor? Just write the most horrific article about me. Do it. It helps me. And continues with, I walk toward my car, and just before I get to it, he calls out one more time, will you tell everyone that I was halfway cool? What is going on with Kid Rock?
This is getting pretty sad, but...
I mean, he's adult rock at some point.
Let's
right?
go back to he said the N-word several times during the interview.
And complained about, quote, black women having children they can't afford.
No, I would say he's pretty sincerely MAGA based on that.
I think he's kind of like, I found my people.
The writer also said, the guy who interviewed Kid Rock said that Kid Rock wanted him to stay the night.
Oh, God.
Oh, my God, imagine.
Spend the night with me. Who would say yes to spending the night with Kid Rock?
Right.
Pamela Anderson.
Yeah, that's your point. Okay.
But waving a gun around, drinking.
N-word.
The N-word. I mean, it's kind of like a bingo card.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Oh, can't wait till that comes out. AMC isn't clowning around when it comes to Goodfellas. Back in 2020, the network added a trigger warning to the film, warning viewers that, quote, this film includes language and or cultural stereotypes that are inconsistent with today's standards of inclusion and tolerance and may offend some viewers. But the disclaimer only recently went viral after former New York Post reporter Kevin Lovett tweeted out, now I've seen it all, AMC message before the classic film Goodfellas. An AMC rep told the Post, quote, in 2020, we began adding warnings in front of certain films that include racial or cultural references that some viewers might find offensive. Many actors and directors have spoken out against trigger warnings being attached to films, including Kate Blanchett, who told the Sunday Times, quotes, "We are terrified of tough conversations, but we need them. We talk about radical candor, but when there's a trigger warning in front of something, you are implying that there's a lack of mutual respect or that there's a subject that hasn't been properly interrogated."
Huh. So, they didn't like him pointing out that the mafia is mostly made up of Italian guys, huh? is that what the problem was?
What I find it weird is that this has been going on since 2020 and people are barely discovering, like, there's a trigger warning in front of this movie. But it's been happening since 2020. Scarlett
Johansson. They even talk, in The Sopranos, they talk about it. Like, Tony Soprano in some scenes is bitching and moaning about the way Italians get portrayed in movies and television.
Oh, really?
That's interesting.
Like some kind of stereotype. Meanwhile, he's whacking guys. And he's got a gumara on the side.
He's ordering gabagool all the time.
Yeah, the gabagool. His boat is called the Stugats.
Never saw The Sopranos. Sorry about that. Scarlett Johansson said that she turned down OpenAI's request for her to lend her voice to a conversational ChatGPT system, and that she was shocked and angered that the company went ahead and used a voice that sounded very similar to hers anyway. Johansson, in a statement provided to Variety, said her lawyers contacted OpenAI to have the voice of Sky, one of the new voices in the GPT-4o chatbot, pulled down. OpenAI last week introduced the Sky voice, which sounded very much like Johansson's disembodied AI companion in Spike Jonze's 2013 movie, Her, in a demo of GPT-4o. The company earlier Monday said it would pause the use of the Sky voice and said, quote, "We believe that AI voices should not deliberately mimic a celebrity's distinctive voice. Sky's voice is not an imitation of Scarlett Johansson, but belongs to a different professional actress using her own natural speaking voice."
Hmm. That just happens to sound so much like Scarlett Johansson.
That happens to have that little voice that she has, like this like breathy voice. Johansson said that she had been contacted by OpenAI CEO Sam Altman in September of 2023 about the company hiring her to provide the voice for ChatGPT 4.0. She said that she declined for personal reasons. And finally, Graceland, the historic home of Elvis Presley, is set to be sold off at a foreclosure sale this Thursday, according to a legal notice.
What?
But Presley's granddaughter is fighting the sale with a lawsuit saying the claims are fraudulent. A temporary restraining order on the sale was granted Monday, according to an attorney for Riley Keogh. An injunction hearing is set for Wednesday, and Priscilla Presley, Lisa Marie's mother, wrote on her ex account, it's a scam. A notice published this
Wait a minute. Did Tom Selleck talk them into a reverse mortgage?
It's possible, right? A notice published this Monday states that Graceland and surrounding acreage on Elvis Presley Boulevard is set to be auctioned off for cash to the highest bidder on the Shelby County Courthouse steps May 23rd. The legal notice states that Lisa Marie Presley allegedly signed a deed of trust in 2018, securing a $3.8 million loan with a Missouri company called Nassany Investments and Private Lending, using Graceland as collateral. The company claims that she never paid that money back before she died last year.
So they don't take Graceland.
So they're like, we're taking Graceland. But Presley's daughter, Riley Keogh, says a 60-page lawsuit against Nassany Investments filed May 15th in a Shelby County court that her mother had never borrowed any money from that company. She also claims that Presley's signatures on the deeds are forgeries and that Nassany Investments is not a real entity. According to the suit, the notary involved in the deed denies that she notarized Lisa Marie Presley's signature or ever met her. So we will see what happens to Graceland.
So Lisa Marie, who passed away, is the one that they're saying signed the thing.
Yes.
Okay.
And so now the granddaughter of Priscilla Presley's, Lisa Marie Presley's daughter, Riley, is saying that they're all forgeries. Mm. And now even the notary has come out and said she never even met Lisa Marie Presley.
There's a lot of drama going down.
Who will get Graceland next? With your entertainment news, I'm Joanna Barba.
Hey, so this was official. There'd been signs, but yes, Red Lobster has filed for bankruptcy.
It happened. And yep. Miss Shrimp.
They say that one of the promotions that was the nail in the coffin or the straw that broke the camel's back was that Endless Shrimp.
They're like, wow, people really like shrimp.
Red Lobster, the corporation said it had more than $1 billion in debt and less than $30 million in cash on hand. It plans to sell its business to lenders and will continue to close restaurants. We don't know if all of the Red Lobsters are going to be closed, but it looks like they are insolvent.
One day only, it's a Red Lobster fire sale. Everything must go.
You got crabs?
We got crabs.
I love hush puppies.
We got those too.
How about just packs of tartar sauce?
Come on down and stock up.
Shrimp?
We don't have any more shrimp because you gluttons ate all of it during our unlimited shrimp deal, which sent us spiraling into debt to the point the only way we could make ends meet was to close locations and hawk light fixtures for $10 a pop. Which reminds me, you want light fixtures? We got light fixtures. The Red Lobster fire sale. Hurry before we turn into another Raising Cane's.
Oh. Show is done.
Are we done here?
We are done here.
I'd like to discuss this further, but I gotta go.
It's been real, and it's been fun, and it's been real fun.
Goodbye, 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 goodbye.
The Morning Show will be back tomorrow at 6 a.m.